This Saturday, tomorrow, April 29th, 7:30 p.m., at QED in Astoria, Queens, we will be doing a live taping of this show, of the David Feldman Show. Listen to this lineup of guests, folks. Comedian Sean Donnelly, who you've seen on Conan and Letterman, he will be a guest, along with David Feldman Show regulars, Angela Cobb, you know him, and some of you hate him, Pat Dixon from the New York Crime Report. He kicked my ass in the roast battles, and I love Pat Dixon. He's incendiary. You don't want to miss this. Tickets are only $8. To purchase in advance, go to QEDAstoria.com and search for the David Feldman Show. I will personally shake everyone's hand after the show. I'm bringing Purell. Not for me, for you. You're going to want to clean your hands after you shake my paws. And you'll get a chance to see my hair plugs up close and personal. I will let you touch my hair plugs if you show up to QED. This is how desperate I am. On tomorrow, April 29th at 7:30 p.m. at QED in Astoria, Queens. If you come out to see me, I will let you touch. You can run your fingers through my lush and verdant hair plugs. Go to QEDAstoria.com. Search for the David Feldman Show. $8. And, you know, if you know somebody who lives in Astoria, but you're living overseas, buy them a ticket as a gift. $8. The more of you who show up, the more of these we will do. Donald Trump this week unveiled his new tax plan, which turned out to be not to pay any. It's 3 a.m. Friday, April 28th, 2017. I'm David Feldman. We have a lot of show, so let's get right to it.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, DavidFeldmanShow.com. Please friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. On today's show, three of the biggest names ever to come out of my hometown, San Francisco. Comedian Chris Titus, comedian Mark Pitta, and this is huge, chef Jeremiah Tower, plus my new friend, Dave Chappelle calls him untouchable because he has leprosy. No, he is one of Dave Chappelle's favorite opening acts, and he's writing for tomorrow night's White House Correspondents Dinner. Comedian, lawyer, husband, father, son, and Holy Ghost, Azhar Usman, stay with me.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
We have three comedians on this show today. I want to tell you first about Jeremiah Tower, Chef Jeremiah Tower, because if you know anything about food, this is a big thing to have Jeremiah Tower on my show. And if you don't know anything about food, you need to know who Jeremiah Tower is. It all starts with Jeremiah Tower. Before Mario Batali, before Thomas Keller's The French Laundry, before Wolfgang Puck, there was Jeremiah Tower. He was the first celebrity chef. He created not only California cuisine, he created American cuisine. He created farm to table. He created the whole notion of becoming a locavore. He is on the show today. Jeremiah Tower is responsible for Chez Panisse in Berkeley, California. And Chez Panisse is responsible for this whole idea of eating locally sourced food. I know it sounds crazy. You young kids don't realize this, but there was a time before Starbucks when coffee tasted like crap. Well, it's hard to believe this, but Jeremiah Tower in the late 70s and early 80s said, to hell with French cuisine, to hell with flying in fish from Chile, let's cook with what's right in front of us. You all take that for granted, but until Jeremiah Tower, nobody knew what fresh food tasted like. I'm being serious. There's a new documentary out. It's called The Last Magnificent. It is the story of how Jeremiah Tower didn't just revolutionize modern dining. He created it. In this documentary, Martha Stewart, Mario Batali, and Anthony Bourdaine sing Jeremiah's praises. They all say it begins with Jeremiah Tower. The Last Magnificent is a magnificent documentary. It's produced by Anthony Bourdaine. Go see it. You'll never look at food again the same way. So much of what we take for granted started with Jeremiah Tower. In the early 80s, he went on to create Stars Restaurant in San Francisco, and then, poof, he disappears. Fell off the face of the earth. Nobody knew what happened to him. He walked away from it all, left at the top of his game, only to return 2 years ago to run Tavern on the Green here in New York City, as well as serve as the subject of this fantastic documentary, The Last Magnificent. I would put it up there with Jiro Dreams of Sushi, that great 2001 documentary that covers Jiro Ono, the 85-year-old Japanese sushi master who runs a hole in the wall that has 3 stars from Michelin. This is on par with Jiro Dreams of Sushi, The Last Magnificent. I am so proud to have Jeremiah Tower on the show today. Another San Francisco treat, Christopher Titus joins us. Christopher is working on his 8th comedy special. This one's entitled America. Really? It's about Donald Trump. You know Christopher Titus from the Titus podcast, his series on Fox, and we relive the early days of the San Francisco comedy scene. And while I'm on the subject of the San Francisco comedy scene, Mark Pitta, seen him on The Tonight Show, all the late night shows. Mark Pitta joins us. I think one of the most underrated comedians working today. We talk about the first time he did Carson, hanging out with all his heroes, including Mort Saul. Do you know who Mort Saul is? Find out who Mort Saul is. We talk about Mort Saul. If you like comedy, you better know who Mort Saul is. And then we wrap it up with Azhar Usman. He's a really funny guy, a comic and a lawyer, and I hold that against him. I really do. He's writing on tomorrow's White House Correspondents Dinner, so I bust his chops for doing that, mostly because he's a lawyer and a comedian. And speaking of the White House Correspondents Dinner, here's something you will never hear on CNN, MSNBC, or Fox News. I made a mistake. I made a mistake on this show, so I want to correct it before you hear it. This is something you never hear on TV news or somebody, say, in a marriage. I made a mistake. During my conversation with Christopher Titus, I say that Ayn Rand's real last name is Rosenberg. I stand corrected. It's Rosenbaum. So I apologize to anybody named Rosenberg. I know how detrimental it must feel to be identified with Ayn Rand. Ayn Rand's real name is Rosenbaum, not Rosenberg. I hope you check out Azhar Usman. He's really a great guy. And besides being an hysterical comic, as I said, he's a lawyer. And we talk about Ann Coulter, who is speaking at Berkeley. Or not speaking at Berkeley, who cares? It's just, oh, my First Amendment rights. Last time I checked, the First Amendment doesn't guarantee the right of a wounded dog to bark all night. Just shut up. I'm so tired of this First Amendment argument. First of all, she's charging $20,000 to speak at Berkeley. So it's not free speech. It's 20 large speech. The money is not coming out of Berkeley's coffers. It's not coming out of Berkeley. So it's not really a First Amendment issue. You know, Berkeley, you can only claim First Amendment oppression when the money is being denied to you by the government. And yes, Berkeley is a state school. But this money that she's getting paid doesn't come from the government. It comes from Young Americans for Freedom and Bridge USA. These are two conservative organizations. They preach fiscal discipline. You know, we can't spend more money than we have. We have to cut food stamps, cut welfare, cut Social Security, live within our means. But somehow they have $20,000 to blow on Ann Coulter speaking at Berkeley. Is Ann Coulter worth 20 grand? All the money that Young Americans for Freedom and Bridge USA, all the good that they can do with 20 grand? You know how many people need 20 grand? You know how many conservatives need 20 grand? And they're going to throw it at Ann Coulter, Ayn Coulter, to come speak at Berkeley as though there's no other place in the Bay Area Ann Coulter could speak? It has to be Berkeley? What is that about? Well, I'll tell you what it's about. 10 years ago, the Washington, D.C. City Council, primarily African-American, they invited a financial consultant, a white guy, to come in and talk to them about balancing the budget. During the meeting, this white financial consultant said something to the effect, you know, you could cut social services, but then you would come across as being niggardly. And the African-American city council members were offended by his choice of the word niggardly. Of course, all the conservatives on Fox jumped on this and said, niggardly is a word. It's in the dictionary. It means cheap. Obviously, according to Fox and Rush Limbaugh and Sean Hannity, these black, these African-American city council members were offended because they don't know the definition of the word niggardly. All they had to do is look it up in the dictionary. It's in the dictionary. They know the definition of the word niggardly. The N-word is also in the dictionary. Just because a word is in the dictionary, it doesn't mean you should use it. Anybody who is sitting on the city council in Washington, D.C. knows that niggardly means cheap, tight with a buck, frugal, tight-fisted, miserly, close-fisted, penny-pinching, parsimonious, stingy, Scrooge-like. You get the point? Of all the words this white man could have used to express the word cheap, of all the words out there, he chose, in front of an all-black audience, niggardly. So what's that about? Seems to me this white guy should stop being so niggardly and spring for a thesaurus. There were plenty of words he could have used in front of an all-black audience other than niggardly, but he wanted a reaction. He wanted to say niggardly in front of an all-black audience so they could be offended and all the conservatives could say, black people don't know the definition of the word niggardly. We're too sensitive. The politically correct are foisting censorship on us. Isn't this horrible? That's what Ann Coulter speaking at Berkeley is all about. With all the venues in the Bay Area, Ann Coulter being funded by the Young Americans for Freedom, by Bridge USA, these conservative organizations with so much money behind them, Ann Coulter just had to pick Berkeley. Why? Because she wanted a riot. She wanted a riot the same way Milo Yiannopoulos from Breitbart News wanted a riot when he tried to speak at Berkeley. With all the stuff that's going on in the world, we really need Ann Coulter showing up at Berkeley. Didn't she die off last year at the Comedy Central roast? I thought we killed her. Didn't we destroy her? Didn't she wake up and realize that everybody hates her, which they do? Everybody hates Ann Coulter. But you can't destroy a cockroach like Ann Coulter because they are not human. Ann Coulter is not human. And most importantly, she is funded by Regnery Press, the Koch brothers. The faucet of money coming her way makes her totally indestructible. And it doesn't matter how despised she is and how irrelevant she is. You cannot destroy a cockroach who is getting money from the Mellon Scaifes, the Koch brothers, the Mercer family. It doesn't matter what they say, how humiliated they are. The money from the right-wing plutocrats keeps coming in because Ann Coulter is a useful idiot. Remember I talked about sleeping giants? It's a Twitter feed that exposes corporations that are advertising on Breitbart. They're advertising inadvertently. They don't know that they're advertising on Breitbart. And, you know, God bless Sleeping Giants. It's a great Twitter feed, and they're getting a lot of people to stop advertising on Breitbart. But I said, when I was telling you to follow Sleeping Giants, I said it doesn't matter. You cannot get rid of Breitbart. And right after I said that, Bannon, Steve Bannon, who ran Breitbart, did his financial disclosures. And sure enough, he draws a salary from Breitbart that is funded by hedge fund billionaire Robert Mercer and his daughter Rebecca. Breitbart doesn't run on advertising. It is funded and paid for by right-wing, racist, environment-destroying plutocrats. Robert Mercer. Look him up. Look up Robert Mercer. He's among the earliest and strongest backers of Donald Trump. And Mercer has a political agenda, just like Sheldon Adelson, who runs the Venetian, and the Koch brothers. People like Ann Coulter or Steve Bannon, you cannot destroy them because they get their money from a handful of the richest families. And as long as Ann Coulter or Steve Bannon carry the water for these families hell-bent on destroying our economy and our environment, you cannot ruin them because money is their lifeblood. That's all Bannon and Coulter care about. They don't care that they're hated. All they care about is money because they're not human. They're cockroaches. Bill Kristol, another cockroach. He started the Weekly Standard. And, you know, the National Review, Buckley, another cockroach, the National Review. Look at these conservative rags that preach the genius of the free market, you know, the Ayn Randian free market, Milton Friedman free market. The truth is that Bill Kristol and Bill Buckley, they could never survive without the quiet funding of Rupert Murdoch, the Welch family, the Koch brothers, the right-wing industrialists whose agendas they serve. Bill Kristol, Ann Coulter, they will tell us the free market, the invisible hand, is good enough for us when a corporation transfers all our jobs overseas. But there's no free market demand for their writing. There's no free market screaming for Ann Coulter and Bill Kristol and Bill Buckley. They are subsidized by right-wing industrialists. I know Ann Coulter's books are supposedly number one bestsellers, but that's only because the Koch brothers order 5,000 copies on Amazon. That's how you create a New York Times bestseller. There's a trick to it. There's a trick. If Regnery Press, if the wealthy industrialists behind Regnery Press buy 10,000 copies of Ann Coulter's book, it's a bestseller. Nobody reads that crap. Nobody reads books by Bill Kristol. And that, my friends, Ann Coulter not going away after the Comedy Central roast, well, that's the final nail in that coffin. And you know what? It isn't. Ann Coulter, speaking at Berkeley after the debacle on Comedy Central, after her debacle on Comedy Central, she is a cautionary tale in the age of Trump. In the age of Trump, if you're right wing and you're a useful idiot, you can continue to be a fool, to be wrong about everything, and you cannot be destroyed, because in the age of Trump, even a broken clock is right 24 hours a day. Trump is not going away. He's not going away. The same way Ann Coulter isn't going away. Trump, I don't see him getting impeached. You know, Russia, Putin, Flynn, Jared Kushner's nefarious ties to gangsters, all this stuff, we keep going, oh, that's it. You know, Ivanka got booed in Germany. Now they're going to go away. No, they're not going away. All this corruption that we think is a smoking gun, Trump doesn't go away. The stuff goes away. That's what goes away the minute there's a terrorist attack and Trump goes to war. Before 9/11, all anybody could talk about was Dick Cheney's secret meetings with oil executives when he was drafting the Bush administration's energy policy. Who was meeting with Dick Cheney when he came up with energy policy? We need to see the White House logs. No, we're not going to show you the White House logs. It's executive privilege. But how are we going to know who was writing Dick Cheney's energy policy? And then there was Enron orchestrating these illegal, criminal, rolling blackouts in California, which literally killed people. And these rolling blackouts, Cheney blamed on deregulation instead of the corruption that was Enron. And that got proven. It got proven that the rolling blackouts in California, they caught people on tape working for Enron, bragging about just literally turning off the lights in California. But Cheney said, oh, the lights went out because it was deregulation. This was criminal behavior, but guess what happened? 9/11, and everybody stopped caring. We had smoking guns, but nobody cared because of 9/11. The investigation stopped. There wasn't enough manpower. You know, when you're cutting the budget of the federal government, there isn't enough manpower to investigate the corrupt, hateful people who are cutting the budget. That's why people like Trump want to cut funding for the IRS. They don't want to be investigated. I'm not trying to be negative here. I'm really talking to myself here. I'm trying to get my heart started because I have Trump fatigue. You know, I'm saying this to myself. We're in it to the bitter end. You know, go look at John L. Lewis, the congressman. It never stops. The fight continues 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Go listen to that great speech by Ted Kennedy at the 1980 Democratic Convention in New York. The fight never stops. It never stops. And I have fatigue. I have Trump fatigue. But the fight cannot stop. I have to stay on top of this until the bitter end. I can't throw up my hands and say, the body politic is riddled with so much disease. There's no point in trying to fight it. You know, there's so much corruption. I don't know where to start. That's how I feel. I think we all feel that way right now. Every day you pick up the newspaper and it's like living next door to a slaughterhouse. Eventually you start getting used to the stench, but I cannot allow myself to accept the stench. This is not right. This is not normal. But I pick up a newspaper and my eyes glaze over and I just go, you know, Steve Mnuchin, this cockroach unveiling this tax plan, this lying Goldman Sachs apparatchik, and my eyes glaze over and I think, why do I have to read lies? I try to read the Washington Post. I try to read Politico. It's just lies. It's just a lie. They're bringing back the Laffer curve and lying about how tax cuts jumpstart an economy. It's been proven to be a lie. It is a lie. Reagan sold us the Laffer curve back in the 80s and said, if you cut taxes for the richest 1%, it will flood the treasury with so much tax revenue, will balance the budget. That's a lie. It was proven to be a lie. George W. Bush said that lie, and it was proven to be a lie. The budget deficit and the debt kept going up, up, up. And now we're hearing the same lie from the same people who are funded by the very same people who fund Ann Coulter and Bill Kristol and Bill Buckley. It's the same right-wing industrialists who pay liars to lie. It's a lie. But in America, as long as you're getting your funding from the Mercer family, a hedge fund manager who benefits by getting his taxes cut, he's paying Trump, Mnuchin, who's our Treasury Secretary, Ann Coulter, Bill Kristol, he pays them to lie. So I'm tired of reading lies. I'm tired of being lied to, and I'm tired of legitimate news organizations having to dignify these lies Even, you know, even when they're disproving these lies, I'm going, this was, you know, what are we doing here? Why are, it's like, didn't we settle this in 1982 when Reagan tanked the economy by giving tax cuts to the richest 1%? But, you know, after a while, you know, I just go, okay, I'm used to the stench, but I'm not going to accept the stench. And this show, you know, we've been booking a lot of comics past couple of weeks because they're really the only honest people I know. I'm booking a lot of comics because I need about another week and then I'll rejoin the fight against the Republicans and Trump. But right now, it's like there's a dying ape in my living room, and it's just sad. It stinks. And America, it's like this dying ape in my living room. And it feels like all I can do is just wait for the ape to die and then dispose of it and then go out and get a pet that's legal and start from scratch. But that's not the way it works. We have to fight. I have to fight. I have to focus, and I have to fight, and I will fight. But on today's show, it's light. It's light. Jeremiah Tower, food, Mark Pita, comedy, Christopher Titus, comedy, Azhar Usman. Actually, if that gets a little heavy there. Stay with me. Welcome back. As many of my listeners know, I started in San Francisco and I went on to fame and success. I was on Evening at the Improv and I did Caroline's Comedy Hour. But, you know, I haven't forgotten where I came from. I always want to look back and bring the guys along with me. Joining me from, is it Hollywood? Is that where you're calling from?
Yes, North Hollywood, yes.
North Hollywood is a young kid I started with named Christopher Titus. You know, I figured, help a brother out, as I like to say. And if you don't know who Chris Titus is, he's a very good comic. You should check him out, see him work. And that's what this show is all about, introducing my audience to comics who just kind of, you know, may not be part of the vocabulary yet. Welcome to the David Feldman Show, Chris.
Thank you, David. I appreciate you having me on, man. You're so nice to like give me the time. I can't believe it. I rent a little soundstage in North Hollywood. I live up in the Hollywood Hills now.
Oh,
but I guess I still got to work. I haven't made it well enough to really, you know, not just to be able to sit on my butt and collect money. I'm still trying though.
Oh, you live up in the Hollywood Hills, so like, is it a little like?
So I appreciate the help.
What do you like? You do handiwork, and in exchange, somebody gives you a place to live.
We bought a house after I had a TV show for a little while on Fox and we bought a house up there, and it's nothing big. It's not like Steven Spielberg's house. It's just a house.
I'm sorry. You said two things and I don't think I heard you properly. You said you own a house and then you had a series on Fox. How come?
I actually have two houses. I have a house in the Sierras too to go skiing and stuff. Yeah, I had a series on Fox for 3 years. I was a writer on it, and that's why, you know, this will help kind of get it out there to people that I had a TV show. So thanks for letting me on your podcast, buddy.
Huh. You own two houses and you had a series on, and it says here you're
playing a little club next week, a little hole in the wall in the Midwest. Where is that?
Oh yeah, we're doing some small shows. We're doing on May 4th. We're doing a Vogel Hall in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. It's a theater, and then the Rouse Center in Crystal Lake, Illinois, on May 5th, and then May 6th. And by the way, thanks for getting this out there. The Goshen Theater in Goshen, Indiana, and then I'm playing a club. I'm playing a club on May 18th to 20th. Comedy Works Out. And that's just a little 450 seat club that I play. So you're helping. Are you okay?
No, I'm fine. I'm fine. Hey, Chris.
Yeah.
Hey, good for you. Good for you,
thanks, buddy. Well, you look at you with the podcast. I appreciate it. And you with the podcast, you're doing so well. I mean, and that you're helping guys like me is it's Gandhi-esque, if I may say that. Thank you.
Yeah, I want to. Is it pay it forward? Is that what it's? Because so much good has come my way,
right,
that I just feel I should. You know, don't pull the ladder up behind you. Bring up. You're playing a theater. How many people in the theater?
Three theaters. It's. I don't know. I think they're. It's not big. It's like it's a thousand, like 1,100 seats each one. I don't know. David. David, are you okay?
Good for you, Chris. Good for you. Anyway.
Hey, yeah. You know what I'd like to do for you? Because you're helping me out. I just wrote and directed a movie that'll be out this year. And we're going to do another one. David. David, are you okay?
A movie.
David.
Yeah, no. I think I just had a bad clam. You wrote a movie, huh?
Yeah, we did it. It's called The Special Unit. We used actual disabled actors in it. The premise is, due to the Fairness and Disabilities Act, the LAPD has to hire 4 handicapped undercover detectives, and I play Nick Nolte's mugshot. I play the worst cop in LA, and we got it shot. It was my first feature, and we're gonna shoot another pilot in a couple months too for another TV show. Hey, how are you doing?
You wrote and directed and starred in your own movie. Is that what you're telling me?
Yeah, and actually the fun part about it was, yes.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'll send it to you to watch.
Go ahead. You were going to say the fun part?
Fun part is I wrote the movie a while ago because we did a pilot at Comedy Central in 2006, and I was really mad because Comedy Central said no, and it was all the disabled actors. And although Hollywood talks a great game about disabled actors, they rarely put them in. So it took me 10 years to get it made. We had production date set. Out of the blue, I get a phone call from Peter Farrelly from the Farrelly Brothers, and he gave me script notes, and I did a... David?
Peter Farrelly from the... Go ahead. You go ahead.
Yeah, for the Farrelly Brothers. Mm. And he, just so you know, and this will probably make you happy, he read my script and blowtorched it. He basically gave me more notes than I've ever had in my life.
Go on.
In the past, I would get notes. You know,
but how did you feel?
How did you feel about that?
How did you feel about being rejected and spat upon by one of the Farrelly Brothers? That must have been difficult. I hope you were able to get through that. All right.
I have to be honest, when I hung the phone up that first note section, I honestly, but then again, it was Peter Farrelly. And in the past, I wouldn't listen to executives. You know, if you've never written a joke, don't give me advice on jokes. I've been doing comedy 30 years. We started together. So when Peter Farrelly did, I did every note that he gave me. You know, I was a good boy. I went and I did everything he said. And it was interesting because he's done some of the funniest movies of the last 20 years. So I didn't, and Kingpin's one of my favorite movies. I took all his advice like a student. And then I sent it back to him and he called me again and he said, can I give you notes on the rewrite? And I was like, oh no. And at that that point, my soul was literally shaved down. And so I got ready for the note session, and I sat there, and I was ready for him to tear the script apart again. And he called me back, and he said, "This is great. I have three joke notes."
Oh, let's go back to when your soul was shaved and you were broken. And so
it's horrible.
Let's focus in on that. So were you depressed? Did you start drinking again? Did you have sexual dysfunction? Let's really explore that period where you had been rejected by one of the Farrelly brothers. And let's just talk about that for an hour, if you don't mind. How did it feel to be rejected? How did it feel?
I tried to focus on the fact that one of the best comedy writers of all time was kind of helping me out. But it didn't feel like rejection. He's probably the nicest guy in the world.
So you doubted yourself. You didn't feel you were deserving. You probably went to Las Vegas and gambled away a lot of money and started eating food that you shouldn't be eating, stopped exercising, maybe were, you know, a little impossible to be around with your family, alienated your loved ones, right? How did you get through that?
I went to the gym and with my trainer and I worked out and I just wrote the script and had a friends help me with
this. This is so inspirational that you were able to overcome this. This is so valuable for my listeners, and good for you, Chris, that you were able to rise above this. And how long did this last? A year? How long were you like? How long did this go for? Rock bottom.
Oh, it was an 80-page rewrite. So, I mean, 80 pages. That took me about. I wrote it in about 9 days.
nine horrible days. And what did you learn during those 9 days about yourself? What did you learn? I bet you can draw from that even today. What powers did you discover that you didn't think you had during that 9-day wilderness period?
That I can take notes from someone who's in. I didn't learn. I just wrote a. I learned that you just keep it, I wrote a script. I have a Writers Guild nomination for my TV show, so I know how to. I mean, I just
Yeah, don't bring that up again, please.
Sorry. If Peter Farrelly ripped my script, it probably wasn't deserved, right?
Mm-hmm.
It was probably some sort of sham, you know, it's just the Writers Guild of America. So it's a sham organization it was no big deal, you know. Okay. And then we got beat by Everybody Loves Raymond anyway, so it didn't really count, right?
And how did that feel, being rejected by your peers? Everybody Loves Raymond. You started with Ray Romano. You know Ray Romano. That must have hurt,
yes,
seeing him win an award that was rightfully yours. How did you deal with that?
Oh, I don't. Well, I mean, well, I can tell you what James Cameron told me. James Cameron said that your show was brilliant.
I don't really care what James Cameron. You know what? I don't need to know what James. I need to know what James, the director, James Cameron, Avatar, Titanic.
Yeah,
I don't. I want to know.
Angel on Fox.
Yeah, I don't need to know what he said. I need to know what you told yourself during this dark, dark, dark period. Excuse me for 1 second. I live with my mother. Hang on for 1 second. Can you keep it down?
The plumber. This is Terrence, the plumber.
Can you guys keep it down? I live in my mother's basement. It's for reasons I don't want to get into. Do you mind keeping it down, Terrence?
You mind just leaving us alone?
Well, do you mind? Do you mind? Anyway,
we're gonna use the disposal.
Okay. Hello.
Yeah. Hi, Chris. I live with my mother now. It's a long story.
By the way, it's nice of you to let your mom. That's nice to let your mom live in your house with you. That's really nice of you, David. See, that's what I've always liked about you, is that you would give.
Well, technically,
New York, and your mom lives with you. How sweet is that?
Well, technically, it's not my house, I guess, yet. But I guess you could say, eventually, it could be my house if I mow the lawn today and clean out the gutters and. I'm in my mother's house. It's my mother's house, but Hey,
So you gave up your time to caregiver. That's great, man. So what I love about you, David, and I've always loved about you, like whether it's helping me or it's when I was a young comic and now, and then helping you moving in with your mom to help your mom out. I mean, you know, a lot of people would just live in their own houses and they wouldn't, you know, rent their own houses out to live with their mom. I think that's,
yeah,
I wish I could be more you, honestly.
All right, I'm going to be honest with you, Chris. Can I be honest with you?
Sure.
Okay. We started together. Yeah. Yeah. And what's become apparent to me, because I don't really read the trades and I live in my own echo chamber where my mother tells me I'm perfect and it's everybody else's fault. I kind of just assumed that you were Chris Titus, you know, from San Francisco, and you were, you know, some road hack. I feel like you misrepresented, like when you agreed to do the show, I think you misrepresented yourself. I think you lied to me. I didn't know this. I didn't know what was going on in your life, quite frankly.
Well, I mean, I did lose my TV show. That's good. I lost it. I actually lost it off by smarting off to a network president. I lost my TV show.
Uh-huh. Yeah. It's a little late to tell me that now, don't you think? Don't you think you deceived me before?
But I went through a horrible divorce, too. I lost like $2 million in a divorce.
Yeah, but see,
horrible stuff, David. David, I'm just as...
The fact that you lost $2 million in a divorce, you see, that's... Can you understand how that hurts me when you say you lost? Thank you for telling me you got a divorce. I appreciate that. That's considerate, and that was generous. Okay, but then you bring up the $2 million, and do you realize what that does to me? You know, we started together, and for you to say that you lost $2 million in a divorce, can you understand how hurtful that is to somebody like me?
Oh, I know you're upset because you're upset that I lost all that money, but I still had a bunch of money left.
No. I'm not upset that you lost all that money. I'm upset that you had that much money to lose. Do you see how you began this interview under false pretenses? Can you understand how hurtful this is? Yeah.
I'm sorry. I realize I started out by being gregarious and fun, and I didn't realize
and happy and fulfilled yeah, and yeah. fulfilled. I mean,
my second wife is 13 years younger, and she's really the best.
Woo! Hang on, Ma. I'll clean it up, Mom. What? I'll clean it up, Mom, after I'm just doing my show, Mom. I had a bad clam there. 13 years younger than you, huh? Wow.
Yeah, she was a Diesel Jeans model for a while, and now... David?
Yeah, I'm okay.
David, are you okay?
Yeah.
And what she did, Lisa, recently, she's a hard worker. She's a comic now, but she was a bodybuilder. She did those body competitions. She did the Excalibur here in Los Angeles. So, and she got 2 college degrees. David? David, are you okay? David.
Wait, she's educated too? David.
Hello?
She's educated?
Yeah, her mom was a master's of fine arts, and she's also, she was a caregiver for her mom. Her mom just passed recently, and so she's, I've kind of married, so amazing combination of like just a model and honestly like literally a Martin Luther King-esque, Gandhi-esque woman. She's like, I swear to God, it's weird. She's
dude, you're killing me, man. You're killing me, Simon. I had my shirt in my face. It's so hot.
Let's do this. Let's take a quick break.
I was sitting here at my desk.
Let's take a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to catch up with one of my oldest friends. Unfortunately, we'll be right back.
It's hilarious, and to keep playing it, like trying to be positive, and just accidentally slipping into more good stuff.
Welcome back. We're talking to my old buddy, Chris Titus. And hey, so in all seriousness, I am at my mother's and you can hear them talking in the background. Look how with little respect. Can you hear them in the background?
I can hear it. It does sound like you're literally at Thanksgiving dinner at your mom's. Yes.
And I politely said, hey, can you keep it down? I'm talking to it. Nobody cares. Nobody cares about anything other than themselves in this country, right?
That is true. Oh, my God. In this country, man, narcissism. I think cell phones have ruined our society. And we elected the most narcissistic human being on the planet to be president. Selfies. There's no themmies and usies. Tell your kids to get to take themmies and usies because they need to get friends.
Yes.
And your mom is really narcissistic. Just I can hear from here that your mom is incredibly narcissistic.
It's pure passive aggressive behavior. Yeah. It's the definition of
the improv of I think I really enjoyed the I'm just going to use the disposal. That made me laugh really hard. I had my shirt in my face and I was shaking. We were doing that bit that your mom jumped on board this bit. It just out of the blue. It was like an improv troupe on your side.
I have Mark Pitta on the show today. So he is very interesting. Besides being really funny, he's kind of a historian when it comes to the San Francisco comedy scene. And, you know, I don't like going down memory lane. Yeah. Some people do. And
well, I got bodies there. I got bodies. I got bodies in memory lane, so I don't like to go down it at all.
Because we started out at the same time. And I'm going to tell you what I thought of you. And you earlier, before we started, you talked about Jake Johansson doing your show. I want to bring up Jake Johansson, who I have to have on the show. Because he was my guy.
Right.
He was the guy I started with. And Dennis Miller says every comic has the guy who they're competitive with. They compare their careers. And I, unfortunately, idiot that I am, picked Jake Johansson to be the guy I was going to compete against. And I would get these calls from my father going, have you seen this guy, Jake Johansson? I saw him on Letterman. He's amazing. You know, he hides the joke. He tells stories and then just builds these houses and hanging jokes inside of them. It's so sophisticated. Thanks, Dad. Who was your guy? Was there somebody you started with who you measured your career against? Please say it was me.
It was you and Bubs. It was you and Bubs at the beginning, and then as I got, then I flipped hard to Carlin and Robin Williams. but it was when I was in that group. I'm not kidding. In that group, I was you and Bubs were doing. There was a moment in time when you and Larry Bubbles Brown grabbed onto Bobby Bitter and Feldo, and then Bob Rubin came in, and I remember being just shocked and amazed at how there was that one like chapter of San Francisco comedy where everybody was doing these wild ass characters, and the freedom on stage was ridiculous. And when people talk about the alternative scene down here in L.A., I always think, no, I actually saw the real alternative scene in San Francisco. It's started, and Patton came out of that too. Your jokes were always, I think you, Will Durst, and a couple guys I would look to as, maybe you and Will Durst really, how to write a concise joke. That was a big deal. You and Bobby and Bubs too, where I kind of learned how to cut it down by watching you guys. So, and this is not BS, the bit we were doing. Honestly, you guys did shape, I was a 19, 20 year old kid. I see pictures of me back then, and I just go, it makes me shudder. So you guys were nice to me. You were like one of the few people that didn't slam me. And Monty Hoffman, I never wanted to fight a grown man more than Monty Hoffman.
You're the second.
He'd just come in and just shred your soul.
Pitta just on the show. Pitta brings up Monty Hoffman. That's interesting. He passed away, you know.
Yeah. He's the only guy that when I heard he passed away, I was like, I just went to my list and crossed him off because he's on the list.
You know, I may take this out.
No, I don't.
No, this part when my, this is, I'm going to burn in hell for this.
You can leave it for me. I'm that guy.
When Monty was diagnosed with cancer, he said, "I'm going to rape this crazy disease." Yep. I may take that out. I'm going to rape this crazy disease. You know what? The thing with Monty is there are two types of people in San Francisco. Those who, that's not fair. because women, you know, I'm going to, you know, I got along with Monty, and there were certain people who did get along with Monty. If you were a woman, your experience with Monty was kind of different. And I guess there is the sanctimony that comes with white privileged men like me who
right.
don't understand what women at Fox News or in the San Francisco comedy scene went through. You know, there's this sanctimony because I got along with Monty because I didn't have anything he wanted. And I would just say, you know, it's interesting. I apologize, Chris. I'm just, my mind is wandering, but I'm thinking out loud. It's like I had this self-sanctimony where I go, you know, I got along with Monty. I understood him. Yeah, well, he didn't F
yeah, with me. He didn't come in and grab your pussy, though. He didn't, like, so I would watch him outside clubs sometimes, and it was, I've never seen this behavior in a man to this day until we elected the new guy. Hmm. Monty was this guy who would, and I remember standing out, remember that we always hang out in front of the punchline sometimes on open mics night. So Monty would just, whatever girl walked up, if she was single, hey, you want to fuck me? Hey, you want to blow me? Hey. And he would, like, it was this incredible scattergun approach. And every once in a while, every one out of 120 would stop and go, hey, what's your problem? And he would talk to him. And next thing you know, he's with that girl. Mm-hmm. I never saw he didn't pick and choose. He just, whatever, if it's female and had nipples, he walked up to him. He was hitting on it, and he was gross, and some women just went for it. So, but I agree with the white person. You know, women get messed with all the time, and Monty was part of the problem. I mean, literally, assaults and harassment went down 22% when Monty died.
And that is the problem with the human condition. I know women, somebody I really respect, a very spiritual woman in the Bay Area who protected Monty, defended Monty. We all have our narratives. And then there are the facts, Your Honor. We live yep. in a Christian culture. It's all about forgiveness and understanding. But some things are, you know, and we're asked to forgive and understand successful people, or, you know, Monty was funny. Monty was really funny. So we found it, some of us found it in our heart to forgive. And, you know, he's troubled. He was a Vietnam vet. He went through hell. And then there's the bottom line. If you're a woman, how did he treat you? What did he do? And that's the truth that has to be addressed. And when you have white heterosexual male privilege, like I do, I didn't see any of this stuff. So it was like,
well, here's the thing. I got treated because I was a young kid who was trying to come up. Monty treated me like I was the new chicken that just got let into prison. Mm-hmm. I was always treated like that. Monty never backed off me. I saw him do something to Jake one night. We were doing, I think it was the first or second Sam's comedy competition. And you know, Jake, I think it was the year that Jake was smoking it. Like, he had done it before, but there was one year where, I think, didn't Jake won it one year, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And every night he was destroying. And what I saw Monty do, we're all backstage, we're getting ready. I'm out of it. I don't think I ever made the semis in it. And Jake was killing it. And Monty walks up to Jake, who didn't have his headphones in, and he goes, and he literally just said some shit like, hey, Jake, how you doing? You know that bitch you're fucking doing? Why you do some new material? That you've been beating on that shit for like 6 years now. And he just fucking basically, I mean, and it wasn't, you know how we all fucked around? Uh-huh. Like, do you know how we all, like, we would all give each other shit? Are you going to wear that? But it wasn't like that. It had that other level to it where uh-huh. Monty was dead serious. And Jake just put his headphones in, turned, and walked away.
Uh-huh.
And I remember thinking, oh, you're a cocksucker. And there's my problem. I break balls, but I got your back. Monty break balls, didn't have your back. I think that's the difference.
I have to be honest with you about Monty. I remember doing the comedy competition, always coming in last. And I remember, boy, I don't know what this says about me.
Too smart, man.
I know, but I can remember pairing up with Monty at the comedy competition. He was like he was my comedy competition buddy. And, you know, I've blocked.
Do you know why?
Why? Why?
You always had glasses on. I'll tell you why. You were always kind of, you were the intellect of the comics in San Francisco at that time. You were the crazy intellectual one. You were the one that had the smartest political jokes. You had the smartest socially relevant jokes of anybody in that time, of anybody. There was nobody else. I don't think anybody was pushing what you were pushing. Monty was the opposite end of the spectrum. Monty was talking about blowjobs and fucking women and blah, blah, blah. And I don't think he was ever threatened by your comedy, because your comedy was so smart and your comedy was so
interesting.
Smart and above everybody's.
You know,
the only person that I felt was in your league really was Jake. Back to your father. Yeah. We're back to your dad. My dad, everybody he saw on TV, he went, hey, you're not that guy. So it wasn't just Jake. My dad, anybody who, when I started comedy, who he saw on TV, it was like, hey, you're not that guy. That guy's way better than you. So don't feel bad that your dad went one guy. My dad went after everybody, but he told me everybody was better than I was. So that's why I think Monty identified with you, because you were never in Monty's wheelhouse. You know, and Monty knew that. Monty knew there was nothing he was going to write. There was nothing he was going to come up with. You weren't taking his women because you were always such a solid cat. There was something about I totally get why you hung out with Monty, but it was really Monty hanging out with you. You didn't pick Monty.
Okay, and he behaved.
Monty
around,
picked you,
and he behaved around me. See, I never saw it.
He did, because you were that.
That's interesting.
You were that guy when you came in the room. We all kind of, it was when you came in the room. It was kind of like of that era, because I was on the outside. Even when Ruben was around, you know, Ruben even mellowed out around you. Like the craziest guys in comedy, when you came in the room, kind of chilled out. It was almost like the assistant principal had walked in the room.
Exactly.
David's here.
Well, and that's the same goes for the audience. The audience chilled out, and I was the cooler. that was the problem.
I used to stand in the back. I would sit in the back. I would stand whenever you walked on stage. There's a lot of guys you walked out to watch. Some guys I didn't care. There were some guys, Bobby Salem, I didn't walk out to watch. Slayton I would come out to watch sometimes. Mm-hmm. When he would go. But he was already moved to LA. If Bubs was doing, I'd come out to watch Bubs, and I'd come out to watch you, because you were a writer. You would always come up with new stuff. I learned from you guys. I would come out to watch Bob Rubin only because I wanted to see what the hell is he going to do now. But you guys, I would come out to watch you because of your writing. You're
right. Right. No, I agree with you. I agree with you. That was always the who said this to me? Somebody said to me. Oh, Attell said to me that ugly guys are always told they're writers. Like, it's true. Like, everybody would walk up to me and say, "You're a writer. You're not a performer."
Well, that's.
But I'll give you a compliment.
You're not ugly, David.
I'll give you a compliment in a second. Before I ask you about Bob Rubin, would you say, of all the comedians,
no, I want to hear how bad I was.
I'm not going to say you. I'll give you a compliment, because you were great the minute you stepped on stage. And the other thing that annoyed me about you was you came almost fully formed. You stepped onto the stage. The audience instantly liked you. You understood that this was show business. You were young and you weren't cliquish. Because the clique will always leave you behind. You know, you never played to the back of the room. You played to what was in front of you. I was so concerned about what Larry thought and what my friends thought. In all honesty, you know, when you're part of a clique, if somebody succeeds, like Jake, it eats you up inside. You know, when Rob Schneider left the clique, it was like, why would you do that to me, Rob? Why did you go on Letterman? Well, you know, Jake, why did you win the San Francisco Comedy Competition? Don't you realize what that does, not just to me, but our clique? You think you're better than everybody? Who do you think you... But you got it from the beginning that this is business, and you took acting lessons and singing lessons and dance lessons and movement lessons, and those movement lessons really work, because you moved away and you got the idea that
signing a lease in LA is not movement lessons.
But you understood something, that the audience wants to be entertained. This is show business. This isn't about David and Larry working out their girlfriend issues, right?
I got really early on that you guys would do that. And you know, part of you wants to be that guy. You want to be the guy that will make the comics in the back of the lot. But part of me, I would watch you guys to do that. And when Monty would laugh or Bubs would laugh at you or the other guys, I realized that Monty wasn't paying your bills. And I realized that I want to, you got to remember, I don't have any other skills. I was a DF student in California public schools. This was my shot. This was all I had. I gave myself 4 years when I started back then. And I said, if I don't make it in 4 years, I will go to trade school, become a welder, because that's what was going to happen. I have no skills. You guys were obviously all educated. You know, Bubs had an engineering degree, and I knew I was fucked. So I
think the audience smells that.
Instilled by my father.
Yeah, the audience smells that. And that's why they love you. They smell that.
Because I fear and desperation. Exactly. The audience. Yeah. But
I'm being serious.
I'm
being serious. That the audience, if you have, you weren't effete, you know?
Right.
And the audience doesn't like somebody who doesn't need them.
I always wanted.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Well, I don't know about, I thought I was desperate for a while. I thought for a while I performed very desperately. And then when I wrote Norman Rockwell's Bleeding, once I got to LA, I realized the less I cared about what the audience thought, the better I was. But it took me, 12 years to find that. It took me 12 years to find that the best thing, it's such a fine edge. And I tell comics all the time, give me some advice comedy. I said, when I'm on stage and they're not laughing, fuck these people. They can't do it. They're sitting in their seats. Once I found fuck these people, and I don't mean that like I hate the audience. I mean, that's that fine line between I don't care what you think. Here's what I think. And the reason I'm up here is because I know what funny is. So and you have to, it's such a weird razor edge. You have to say fuck these people and also I love these people at the same time. It's such a bizarre thing on that I've learned about comedy.
I never had that. I have it with the podcast because I don't have to worry about the laughs,
right?
But on stage, if they're not laughing, I go into panic mode. So what convinced you, I guess it's doing the one man show, right? That it becomes, that's not stand up. That's a whole other thing, right?
Well, that's the problem is that like I saw a lot of guys do one man shows and they forgot to be funny. And I'd watch, I always try to watch what works and what doesn't work. I'd go watch a lot of comics. And I saw Lily Tomlin do Signs of Intelligent Life in San Francisco down in the Tenderloin. And I remember thinking, wow, and she's kept it so funny. There weren't these big pauses. It was just joke, 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 on top of having a story. So when I wrote Norman Rockwell, the one thing that I committed to is it has to be at least as funny as stand-up. And if I'm funny, if it's as funny as stand-up for an hour and 20 minutes, then I've bought myself the right to take 3 minutes and punch the audience in the aorta as hard as I can. And then I have to be funny again. So it wasn't Norman Rockwell's joke, 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 joke. But I think a lot of comics, when they hear the word a one man show, they believe that is just carte blanche to not be funny. And I think it's the opposite. I think if you're gonna have the pretense and be a pretentious douchebag that you're gonna do a quote one man show, you better make sure that it holds up in any comedy club in the country. And that's how I developed Norman Rockwell. I didn't go rent theaters. I toured it with comedy clubs first to make sure that it was funny. And then once I put the theater on top of it, once I rented a theater and put it in a theater, it took on a whole extra power to it. It took on this extra weight. But I developed it in the shittiest drunk ass Friday second show comedy clubs in the country.
That requires a lot of have you ever not been disciplined? Has there ever been a period?
I don't think I'm very disciplined. I mean, it's all fear. Yeah. I mean, when I was a DS student, I couldn't graduate. I didn't graduate. The joke I do in my new shows, I didn't graduate. I was let go. I'm the only senior that was laid off from high school. So I got out. I actually had to go back after I graduated to get 3 more credits to get my diploma. So I realized I was really, and I talk about this in my new set, Marageddon. I really wasn't disciplined at all. But I loved comedy. Like I wanted to be a comic since I was 5 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved comedy. And I used to listen to Cosby and Cosby was so disciplined. And then I would watch, then I got into Robin to the point where like I was obsessed with Robin Williams.
Do you remember there was a guy
How he did it.
Do you remember there was a comic who came on the scene, who did Robin and didn't realize it? Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yep. I almost beat his ass in San Jose one night. I I was hosting open mic down at the Last Laugh in San Jose, and he got on stage, David, with the suspenders. And at one point, look, if you're
gonna, Kermit, was it Kermit something?
Somebody. He got on suspenders. No.
It was a dude.
He wasn't around long.
Right.
He got off stage. I grabbed him by the front of his shirt outside of where the comics were standing, and I slammed him against a brick wall at the Last Laugh, and I said, if I ever see you get on stage and steal anybody's act again, I will beat your ass in this alley. And you know why? Because to me, there's not a lot of things that I believe that much in, but like when you guys would write jokes, like sometimes it'd piss me off to watch you and Bubs work, because sometimes you guys would do jokes that were right in front of me that I missed. Don't you hate that when a comic does something that's right in front of me and you're like, fuck, I missed that, damn it.
Yeah.
And you guys found it first, and that's the magic of comics, and that's why you can't steal from comics. You can't steal. Look, we all have dads, we all have moms, we all have kids, whatever. You can write those jokes. But when someone finds a tell sometimes will come up with a joke and I just smack myself on the forehead like, holy crap, that was right in front of me and I missed it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I'm very defensive. I busted Carlos Mencia. I watched Carlos Mencia do one of D.L. Hughley's jokes in Vegas. I watched him do it. I stood in the room and watched him. So I know that guy's a thief. Let me say it again. Carlos Mencia is a... This is after South Park roasted him. I watched him do it.
Joe Rogan could kick my ass, right? Would you call Joe Rogan... Would you call him on thievery?
A thief?
No, I'm saying not that he's a thief, but I'm saying if he decided to be a thief...
No, he's not at all.
I know that, but I'm saying since he knows mixed martial arts, would we call him a thief? If he stole something,
it doesn't matter if you're a comic and you step into and by the way, I'm about to get really precious about comedy right now, so please, you can edit this out you want. Comedy is magic. Here's why. Comedy is the only thing that we like. You can play music all day long and sit in a room and talk and drink and whatever, and oh, that's a good song, I'm gonna dance to that. Comedy is the only art form that actually has to create a physical reaction in the person listening to it. So the magic of it is it has to actually, and it can get, and I'm sorry to get precious about it, but it literally has to fire something in your brain that makes you physically react. You have to start laughing. So it's magic. And the guys that do it and can do it well, and the guys that I look up to, are the best at it. If you're going to steal someone else's magic, fuck you. I will find you. Will I beat your ass? No, but I'll make sure everybody knows. I'll screw you. I'll tell everybody you did it. Then I'll go film you somewhere. Then I'll put it on the internet and let everybody know that you're a thief. It's not okay. It's not okay. It's too hard. Dude, some of the jokes you've written, like if I saw someone stealing your stuff, I would do the same thing. I take it too seriously. Cause some comics don't care. They don't care. And I'm not talking someone doing like that wall joke. That was the weird thing. Like when he went up to Mencia
and he did
the wall joke.
That was like
that joke. I didn't even go. But here's so Rogan. That was just one piece. But here's what happened with Mencia. So Mencia, I didn't believe it until I started going online and someone had started posting stuff from his album. When I ran into Carlos in Vegas, I walked right up to him and I said, hey man, and I go, how's everything going? He goes, what do you mean? And I go, with all the stealing. And I don't know Carlos. That was literally our first two sentences. And he goes, oh man, he goes, come on. I go, no. I said, no. I said, honestly, I saw you steal. He goes, I said, not the wall joke. I said, I saw you do the Bill Cosby football piece. You know, the kid about, and his dad helps him. He did it on one of his specials, and I said, I saw that piece. That's not your piece. And here's what he says. Here is a sociopath. Carlos doesn't say, yeah, I should. Carlos says to me, we're standing in Vegas, talk face to face. So this isn't a hearsay story. This happened. I was standing in front of him. He said, he goes, oh man, he goes, I got real arrogant. He goes, you know, we filmed that bit on the special, and then we cut it out of the special on Comedy Central, and then when they released the DVD, one of the editors put it back in. Man, that's what happened.
Wow.
He never once said, I should never have done Cosby's bit.
Right.
He said the editor fucked him.
Wow.
I was like, no, that's wrong. And then that night, then we had that conversation, David. Then he went on stage at the Dirty at 12:30 at the South Point Casino and did a joke. And I'll say this about Carlos. I get why Carlos works. Carlos is an amazing performer.
Mm-hmm.
That dude, confidence and the way he says things, and he can get an audience fired up. Man, he's got everything that Trump has. He can just get an audience fired up and they don't know what they're fired up about. So I watch him, and then I was driving home and I watched him do a set, and I didn't see anything. But I remembered a couple jokes that were killers. as I'm driving home, I'm listening to Comedy Central Records and radio on Sirius. I'm driving home from Vegas back to LA, and fucking DL Hewley comes on. I'm listening to DL. I know DL, and he does the joke. And I call DL. I go, DL, is that your joke? And he goes, yeah, it's my joke. I said, I saw Carlos do that the other night in Vegas. He just said, DL just goes, thanks for telling me, bro. So that's where it is. That's where it is for me. And I don't mean to make comedy precious, you know. And you guys, like, I look back. I was such the odd man out. I think we all felt like that. But I really felt like the younger
well, you
than
were
everybody.
A kid. You were a
I,
kid.
I didn't really fit in.
You were a kid.
Yeah, no shit.
And by that, I mean you were like 3 years younger, you know, but hey, does anybody ever, let me say goodbye to my mommy and my sister. Bye, mommy.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Don't be a stranger.
Okay. Sorry we didn't have
your Flintstones underpants if you need them.
Okay. I have I have this nightmare scenario where I never left New York. I'm living in my mother's basement. And I never get married. I never have kids. She lets me live in the basement. And I'm the best son. And she just brags about me. Then I put her to bed at 11 o'clock every night or 10. And then I sneak off and I meet young men at the bus station and do horrible things. You know, not sexual. There's like weird. And then I'm out all night. And then I come home smelling of another man's cologne, but I bring my mother a Bialy, a coffee, and the Daily News, and she says, you're such a good son. You're such a good son. And then one day, the police come, and they say, boy, if these walls could talk, and suddenly the walls are talking, because they're, you know, men saying, let me out.
And some are just bodies. Some are just bodies, David. I know. But dude, I remember I was kind of obnoxious at that age. I was really fired up. I was trying to compete with all you guys, and it was impossible. You guys are all, and by the way, you say I was a kid, and when you say 3 years difference, 19 to 23, 24,
it's a big thing.
Is way different. I was 19. I don't know how old you were back then. That's a huge,
of
that's
course.
Literally 15 years of development, 3 or 4 years.
Oh, and
guys had paid bills. And,
what happened after 4 years? You said you gave yourself 4 years. What happened?
I was living in the Lower Haight, and I was eating one piece of pizza a day. I said if I could make a living at it, I was making one piece of pizza a day. I had $700 in parking tickets because fucking San Francisco.
The Haight.
But I was making enough money to pay my bills. I wasn't doing well. All you guys, every once in a while, like we'd all get in a car and go to some horrible nightmare gig in Santa Cruz, or wherever we would go. And I was just making enough money. And then I started calling around the country and basically kind of threatening club owners, going, listen, I go, anybody, you put anybody in front of me, and I would just go crazy on the phone. I was so, it was all fear. It wasn't arrogance. It was like, I said, if I show up, I said, middle me, feature me, pay me this money, you know. And but at the time, I look back, they were laughing at what I thought was a good money. And I would say, if I have one bad show, and I did this in Seattle too, if I have one bad show, don't pay me. And I never didn't get paid. So that's how I kind of broke into some of those clubs.
Wow. You wanted it and you made it happen. You wanted it badly enough.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Well, that's how the movie got done. The movie got done the same way. I learned something. I did a thing called the Landmark Forum, and I learned something that you don't wait for the thing to happen. You decide the thing's going to happen, and then it starts to happen.
Bill Hicks, I remember standing with him at the Improv in L.A., and he was telling me about the Forum. But what is Landmark Forum? What is that?
Just a class. It's a 3-day class. You can look it up. They do it around the world. And basically, they've studied human beings for 5,000 years. What made Hitler Hitler? What made Gandhi Gandhi? You know, why is Trump Trump? And we're all the same machine. So we're all blood, bone, hair, and we all have anger. Even our emotions are all the same. So everybody thinks we're so special, but the reality is we're really not. And so what they did was they kind of broke it down how people react and why some people are successful and some people aren't. And it teaches you to operate your life not out of your past, which is we all do, you know, your mom, your dad, my dad, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It teaches you to operate out of your future. So instead of looking backwards, trying to move forward, you're actually looking towards a goal, and it just changes your life. And by the way, if Hicks did the Forum, I so get Hicks even more now. It teaches you to take a stand for what's right and what you want to do.
Oh, hang on for one second. You know? Let me, really cool. I would never speak for Bill Hicks. I don't know if he did the forum or he was complaining to me about a woman he was dating who did the forum. And
I think trying to get her to do it.
No, I think he was dating a woman and he was complaining that she did the forum, as I remember it. So I would never speak for Bill Hicks. I think he was dating a woman who was trying to get him to do the forum.
The interesting thing is if he didn't do it, the way he performed on stage and the stuff he did is very forum-esque.
Hmm.
It used to be Est is what it is. Do you know what Est was?
Sure. Was it Werner Erhard?
Yes. Werner left West. The company that bought it renamed it, and then it became Landmark Forum. Yeah. And my wife has taken it, and that's how I got the movie done, and that's how I got my own TV show. I wasn't going anywhere, and I took the forum, and then 2 years after that, I had Titus. I have a DF student. I have a Writers Guild nomination. It all happened because of what I learned in the forum.
Well, hang on for one second.
And now I actually rent a studio.
Did Werner Erhard create the forum, or was it? Is that him?
Yeah, it was Est. And then they keep modifying. They don't just leave it as is. They keep like making it better and better. Yeah, Werner Erhard created Est. Est became Landmark Forum. Same technology. They keep moving it every year, and they keep making it better every year. And
is it still around?
My wife's done it. It kicks ass. They say it's one of the top 10 experiences of your life. If you look on the web, it's not religious. It's not political. It's just how do human beings become successful and how do human beings become not successful? And they don't use the word successful. They use,
self-actualize.
What are some of the language?
Self-actualize, self-realize.
Not even. It's not that far. It's transformative. Like it's truly literally transformative a moment to moment of what you think.
Scientology for people who aren't gay.
Yes. No. But yes. Supposedly, the rumor is that what's his face, Elrond, had put a hit out on Werner Erhard. That's why he had to sell the forum, and that's why that story that was definitely proved to be wrong in 60 Minutes came out about Werner, because Elrond Hubbard. It was basically they were friends, and there was the same technology, and Elrond Hubbard wanted to make a church out of it to make money, and Werner Erhard said, "No, we just want to have people give access to a different life. We're not a church." And then Elrond Hubbard said, "Yes, we are. From billions of years ago, the Thetans and Werner Erhard." I went, "Oh fuck, I'm leaving," and he left, and then they put a hit out on him, and that's part of the reason. The rumor is that's why Werner Erhard, they were friends, and then Werner Erhard started Est, and that's when Scientology started, and Scientology is now what it is, and the forum is what it is. But it's an amazing technology.
His name is Rosenberg, right?
Probably. So he's a Jew. Is that what you're saying? Is that what you're saying, David? Is that what you're saying, that he's a Jew?
Are you saying now
he's a Jew? Are you calling him a Jew on the podcast?
I'm saying
he's
that
a Jew, is what you're saying. He's a Jew.
I think what I'm saying is that his real name is Rosenberg.
Jew.
And as was Ayn Rand. I think her last name was Rosenberg. Now the question is, was L. Ron Hubbard? I doubt L. Ron Hubbard was.
His name.
I think it was Steinmetz.
I think it was Elrond Steinmetz.
Well, now you've got me all.
It'll get you out of your mom's house, and you'll have a better life.
Hey, this was. Thank you for doing this. Let's believe it or not, I have some listeners. I know it's hard for you to believe, but I actually have listeners.
And honestly, I've done some podcasts. That first thing we did was some of the funnest thing I've done. I literally had fabric in my mouth because I was trying not to laugh. Because when you started freaking out and puking, I was shaking so hard. It's really funny. May 4th will be at Vogel Hall in Milwaukee. May 5th at the Rowe Center in Crystal Lake, Illinois. May 6th at the Goshen Theater. And then May 18th through 20th, Comedy Works South. I'm working on a whole new show. It's all about the election and Trump. It's called Amerigeddon. In my movie, A Special Unit, you can go to my website, ChristopherTitus.com. Check out the trailer for the movie. It's really funny. Billy Gardell is in it, who's waiting for me right now.
Wow.
Billy Gardell is in this movie, and he plays his character. He plays the police chief. His character is 4 seconds from aneurysm the whole movie, and it is so ridiculously funny. And so we're actually looking for a distributor. right now on that, and that's it, man. And thanks for having me on, dude.
Hey, thank you.
The Titus podcast. I have the Titus podcast. If after you're done listening to the amazing David Feldman podcast, you can go to listen to the Titus podcast.
Okay, and very quickly, I just want you to know, I forgive you. I forgive all your success.
Thank you.
I forgive all your. Thanks, buddy. You're great. Thank you.
Thanks, David. Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Bye. I'm from New York. Director Lydia Tenali. I'm trying to.
That was good.
Yeah.
That's what I'm going to call her from now on.
I wasn't raised to enjoy the Brooklyn palate. I was raised to disguise my voice. Director Lydia Tenali's The Last Magnificent is an amazing documentary playing right now in theaters all over America. The movie, produced by Anthony Bourdaine, chronicles the life and times of Jeremiah Tower, who pioneered California cuisine and the modern incarnation of the celebrity chef. I'm going to go so far as to suggest that you, Jeremiah Tower, are responsible for farm-to-table and the whole idea of locavores. According to Anthony Bourdain, it all starts with Jeremiah Tower, who revolutionized the American restaurant by turning it into a celebration of cooking as well as local ingredients. Thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you, David. Thank you for inviting me on the show.
I know nothing about food, but food is like comedy. Everyone is an expert. Everyone can tell you if it's good or bad. They can't explain why it's good or why it's bad. Can you be a food critic without being able to cook?
Well, you can certainly, let me think about the word critic for a minute. You can certainly be a major food figure. I mean, Julia Child, for instance, couldn't cook, but she recognized good. I mean, she couldn't even roast a chicken, but it's true. It's true.
She would admit that too, right? Could,
not really. I don't think she ever admitted that, but anyway, but she can certainly recognize great food. And I've been told by people who worked with Craig Klebb on that, he couldn't cook, was a terrible cook, and that's why he had Pierre Freinet do all his cooking and testing and for the New York Times. But that didn't matter. He knew what delicious food was. You don't have to be able to cook it to know it.
Taste. Food is a combination, I think. Taste is a combination of smells, textures, how it lands on your tongue. Musicians are born with perfect pitch. They can be taught relative pitch, but you're either born with perfect pitch or you're not. Does the same apply to a chef when it comes to taste? Is there such thing as perfect taste and relative taste? And do you have perfect taste?
You know, I've read about that, and I think it's true that some people, I mean, one's tongue and whole system in the mouth and nasal passages, you know, and sinuses are built to be more accepting of all the nuances of taste, which of course is smell and everything. Yes, I think that just like that, in terms of perfect pitch, there is a perfect pitch of being able to taste things that one is born with. Yes, I agree.
In the documentary, there's one of your chefs, and he hits the glass. He says, there's a tone, there's a tone. And that you would introduce a tone to your chefs, and they'd say, oh, we got to do this. What does he mean by a tone?
That's certainly one of my favorite parts in the movie, in The Last Magnificent, because he just hits the glass with his knife and says, that's what we were looking for. And it's, you know, that clarity, that simplicity, the clarity, the moment. You don't have to spend 15 minutes looking into, diving around into your 15 ingredients that somebody's put on the plate to figure out that it's a mess.
You know? Right.
It's the clarity of a great saxophone note. You know, it's a great clarity of Benny Goodman on the clarinet. It's a great clarity of a brilliant color. That simple, that easily seen, that easily tasted.
Somebody who is brilliant at music, they hear a symphony different than I would. I watch comedy, I guess, differently than other people do. When you bite into something, what are you tasting? You described in the Q&A afterwards having a hot dog at a Walmart in Mexico, and you took you took two bites. One bite was delicious, and then the second bite, you said, that's it, I'm done, and it made you sick. But that first bite of a Walmart hot dog, you said it was a riot of colors and tastes. What are you tasting?
Well, you know, I'm not immune to the power of chemicals. If it was made by Exxon, you know, I approve of gasoline after all.
But what's going through your brain when you bite into something as mundane and poisonous as a Walmart hot dog? I'm being serious. What is there a feeling?
No.
Is there a memory?
No, it's a sort of a rush of the whole combination of flavors. And then, of course, seconds later, or not seconds, but, you know, a minute or two later, I realize that rush is completely artificially created. I admire that, but I certainly don't want to eat it. American fast food tastes wonderful at first bite because it's just it's very carefully orchestrated music. Mm-hmm. But, of course, it's not fast food, it's fast death.
Mm-hmm. They have little eyedroppers that they can put on a bland piece of meat and turn it into sirloin because of the smell. It's mostly about the smell.
Right.
In the documentary, you collect menus dating back hundreds of years. And in acting, there's sense memory. You recall an emotion and then apply it to the character and the scene. Does the same apply to cooking? Right. Can you remember a taste without having the actual food in front of you so that when you're coming up with your own menu, is there a taste you have in your head and you're trying to achieve it? Or when you're preparing a menu, is it empiricism, trial and error, and you stumble into something you like? Or is this, I hate to say, platonic, absolute taste that you have in your head? But are you imagining a taste? I know somebody who told me she can remember what I smell like from, you know, 30 years ago. You remember?
Well, I hope that's a compliment. Sure, it's a compliment.
I was living in Berkeley at the time. I don't think it was a compliment. But do you have, like, a taste that you can remember just in your head?
Yes, I do. And also, if I think of putting an ingredient or putting two or three together, I can immediately taste it. So it makes it a lot easier to actually cook it. If you've never cooked it before, you head for those tastes. And so when you get there, when you lift that spoon of, you know, sauce to your mouth and you taste it, you realize that was what was in your head. And, you know, that's your benchmark. That's your success.
That's in your head without any of the smells, any of the ingredients in front of you.
True. Yes. I mean, it must be an accumulation of all the things I've tasted and cooked and all the things I've loved in my life, but, you know, that's how I can write a recipe for a cookbook without ever testing the recipe and have it come out fine, or so people say.
Wow. In the movie, they show a young version of you going through these menus. There's a thing called tasting menus. Can you actually read a menu and taste it? Just by reading it?
Yes. Yes. I mean, I taste the way I think it should be. I mean, if it says, you know, and the old menus, you know, turtle consomme, I tasted that kind of consomme when I was 7 or 8. I've never seen it again because, you know, now it's illegal. But I did have it, you know, at London's finest restaurant in the 50s. And I remember what it tasted like. So I just read that word on a menu and I can, it's in my head, you know.
Wow.
Almost the same as putting it in my mouth.
That's incredible. I mean, can that be, getting back to perfect pitch versus relative pitch, it can be taught to have relative taste, right? I guess somebody, if they're trained, they can begin to taste things just by reading it?
Oh, sure, sure. I mean, it's, for instance, in a kitchen, once, you know, one time at Chez Panisse, we're cooking dinner, and then my one assistant at the time, Willie, became ill, so I grabbed the dishwasher, who was 19 or 18 or something, and I said, here, I cooked it, he tasted it, he cooked it himself, it was about 85%, and I said, now taste it, now remember, now do it again, and he got it right, so he never washed dishes again.
Wow.
But somebody else couldn't, you know, been there all night trying to reproduce that.
Right. So I started doing comedy in San Francisco. You either were born funny or you're like me. You learn how to be funny. You know, Robin Williams, guys like Stephen Pearl, Jeremy Kramer, these guys were just born funny.
They can't help it.
They can't help it. And they can spot another funny person. They just know. They can sniff out another funny person. Can you sniff out somebody who has taste?
When you get someone, a young cook, you know, or somebody who's just new to the restaurant, for example, and you have them taste something, it's the ones who go quiet. It's not exactly as if their eyes roll in the back of their head, but they're quiet. They don't jump around and say, oh, great, that's fabulous, you know, blah, blah, blah. They stay, they're sort of stunned into silence, even if just for a few seconds. Those are the ones.
And you know it. You know it.
Yes. You can just tell by their, you know, you look at their face and you look at their body language and how they're standing and how they react when this sort of pleasure sweeps over them and makes them still for a second, you know you've got a cook.
Almost a genetic thing, or they were raised a certain way.
I think so. However, that's brought to the table, sorry, no pun intended.
Right.
That is always my way of recognizing somebody who can be trained and to be a great cook.
And then when you're dealing with them, you don't have to say it to them. You know, they know, and you just treat them differently while you're running the restaurant.
Right.
A year later,
right,
they've moved up and passed everybody by.
Well, like, you know, at Stars, it was Dominique Crenn. She came in, and I put her on the line the first day. I could just tell she was somebody who was going, knew what she was doing, was going to know what she was doing, and now she's, you know, one of the most famous female chefs in America, in the world.
I saw the documentary Thursday. It just washed over me. I saw it at the IFC in New York City. There are some people who can't imagine a time that we didn't celebrate local cuisine. I think it was Mario Batali who says in the documentary that you can't really understand a place unless you pay attention to the smells, the breeze, and it's all contained in the local food, the grass, the herbs.
I love that.
That, for me, that
yes.
explained uh-huh. everything about you, because I can't imagine a time in my life, because I lived in Berkeley and I lived in San Francisco, I can't imagine a time in my life when Berkeley and San Francisco had an inferiority complex about the local grown food. But before you, they did?
Well, you know, it's impossible. People just can't believe that all the stuff we have now didn't always exist. But when I started at Chez Panisse, I mean, the only olive oil was, you know, one market down miles away in Oakland. The only fresh fish was, you know, in Chinatown in San Francisco. There were no herbs. I mean, I used to, when I walked to Chez Panisse to cook in the morning, I would steal nasturtiums and rosemary from people's walls. It's impossible to believe that none of that happened. I mean, now that the whole United States is one whole foods market, you know, it sounds ridiculous to say that that didn't always exist.
In the documentary, it shows you going to a farmer's market in Mexico, where you spend a lot of your time. You started to prepare a dish for your neighbors in Mexico. They said, this isn't, I don't remember the name of the town you live in. I don't want to violate your privacy, but let's, for all intents and purposes, call it, I don't know, Juarez. And they would say, this is not Juarez cooking. And you say, well, it should be.
Well, I can happily say that it's Merida in the Yucatan, and it's the Mayan cuisine. And they have three or four dishes that are absolutely world-class. And one of them is built on that black chili paste called chilmole, which is, you know, from incinerating basically arbol chilies, then grinding them up and making a paste. And that's what I put on the octopus in the film.
Right.
One of my favorite things, chile mole.
Talk to me about why it's important in terms of the planet. Why, if we do farm to table, why being a locavore is so beneficial to helping save what's left of this planet?
Originally, I mean, it all started out because there wasn't anything much to buy. So I, you know, encourage people to go up into the hills in Berkeley and pick mushrooms. I mean, the boat boys who came back would quarter salmon or conger eel. They'd bring it to the back door of Chez Panisse. And so it started because that was what was available. But in fact, it's all about, you know, the local stuff is going to be probably the best quality, the freshest. The local produce and ingredients are going to be the, you know, the freshest, probably. And the local ingredients haven't been flown in from Chile on, you know, on a huge jet. In terms of using up our resources, the most gentle impact on the planet is to use local food.
One of the things that struck me in the documentary was, I hope I'm pronouncing this word properly, equanimity, that you seem to have an equanimity. When things went wrong, you kind of smiled and went through it. In the lead up to this interview with you, we had a technical problem, and I got really frustrated because it was a machine and not a human being. I had to reboot the computer, and I'm very intolerant of machines when they screw up. But when people screw up, I'm very forgiving. Is that the way you run a restaurant? I don't think you have a temper. I think the impression I got from the movie was you were very demanding, a control freak. You expected the best from everybody. But
right.
I don't get a sense that you panicked when people screwed up. I don't think you can succeed in a restaurant without nurturing everybody.
Yeah, panicking is counterproductive because, you know, the people are waiting for their dinner. You can't go out and say, I mean, I can go out and say the electricity's off, but they already know that. I can say the cook, you know, just decided he doesn't want to do this, and that's inexcusable because then I would do it. So actually, I can forgive machines and disasters and hurricanes and riots, earthquakes. It's much more the human beings that I can't forgive. But on the other hand, if they're screwing up, it usually means you haven't trained them properly. You know that scene in The Last Magnificent where the young Chinese cook burns the food? And I said, you know, what do you think you're doing? And then it turns out he'd been put on the station by the chef de cuisine, which I didn't notice, that he didn't know what he was doing. So I went over for the rest of the night and started to cook with him and show him how to do the food. And he turned to me and said, well, chef, you know I don't know how to cook. I laughed. I thought that was the sweetest thing a cook ever told me.
Uh-huh.
You know I don't have how to cook. And I said, well, here we go. That's what we're going to do.
The Last Magnificent it's an amazing documentary. It really is. And thank you for doing this. I found stunning, and it's such a great lesson. You went to Harvard, got a master's in architecture. You are obviously well-educated and brilliant. And you run a restaurant. You are paying attention to things that other people would say are beneath you. For example, the flowers. When you were running Stars, you spent six
right.
months on the flowers, learning how the flowers were arranged, how much they cost, who the vendor was. The mindfulness of that. If you want to have a successful business or run a campaign for office like Hillary Clinton, God is in the details.
Absolutely. I mean, if you, in the broad sense, there's no point having good food if the service is lousy or vice versa. You know, I mean, if this perfect waiter, you know, or waiter giving you perfect service brings you lousy food, you know, it none of that makes any sense. It has to be a perfect balance. So it's the feel of the restaurant, the look of the restaurant, the food, the service, the choices, you know, that the owner has made to provide fairly priced, wonderful wines by the glass, you know, great cocktails. And I don't mean cocktails with smoke coming out of them. I just mean, you know, properly made with very good ingredients. You know, I bartended one day a week at Star so I could keep my hand in and see how the bar really ran, you know, and what was possible, what was impossible. So yes, it's, God is definitely in the details all the time.
I had a guest on the show last week who's a comedian and an aspiring Major League Baseball pitcher. He wanted to be a pitcher. He went to Arizona State University. And I asked him about the intersection of stand-up comedy and pitching. And the question I had for him is, when you're pitching or doing stand-up, you are totally in the moment and totally focused to the exclusion of everything else. So when you're running a restaurant, that is the ultimate escape from everything. Is there time when you're running a restaurant to think about anything other than the restaurant? And I bring that up because you quit. You walked away from it. I guess you went to Manila, New York, Mexico. I'm a control freak. Most people are.
Right.
How do you give up all that control? And are you able to let go?
Most chefs are adrenaline freaks. And so, you know, absolutely hooked on high levels of adrenaline. So, I mean, that was one of the things to manage. And I sat down and made a list of, you know, how could I mean, I wrote three books. Now a fourth I'm working on since I left Starz. So I wasn't sitting around doing absolutely nothing. But a book doesn't really provide a solution to all those adrenaline levels. So I went diving with sharks. I figured that would be, you know, the equivalent to a Saturday night at Starz, and it was, you know, and you fall over backwards from a panga into, you know, a little pack of 6-foot leopard sharks. I mean, that definitely.
Is that because you wanted to become the ingredient?
The fresh ingredient. And local, it was right off the boat.
And they didn't eat you. They didn't.
Definitely within 100 miles. Yeah, probably within 10 feet.
One of the things I realized watching The Last Magnificent is they talked about the level of consistency night after night. It's not good enough to be a genius one night. You have to create a dish.
No.
And you have to make that same exact dish 5,000 times. Does it have to taste exactly the same? Are all 5,000 dishes, are they going to taste exactly the same?
No, because you've got various people cooking it. And also in a busy restaurant, if I was cooking that dish all night long, it wouldn't be exactly the same. But it has to be equally as good, and it has to be as close as possible to the original intent.
Mm-hmm.
If it's a piece of perfect fish with a little bit of prawn shell essence and mussel and clam and lobster stock and perfect olive oil and a couple of herbs thrown in, fine. But it can't taste all of herbs or all of olive oil or all of the lobster essence. It has to be a balance. And if you get that balance, there is a small range of changes that you can have and it still be fantastic.
You're running a restaurant. I blindfold you, and I give you the same exact order, two dishes, a pasta dish.
Right.
They're about to go out. Could you sample each dish and tell me why they're different, what was done differently on the subatomic level, on that granular level? Are you able to taste two identical dishes that are about to go out and tell the story of how it was prepared?
Well, I mean, blindfolded, I'm not so sure because, you know, visual smells, body language of the person cooking it, the, you know, the way it's plated, everything comes into play. I mean, that's the only way I could keep my eye on every dish that went out of there because I'm looking at all those things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm looking at how much sweat is on the cook's brow.
Right.
So blindfolded, I could probably tell you why they taste different or taste the same. But I couldn't give you the whole story because I would be missing a lot of it.
After you left San Francisco, molecular cuisine.
That's a cooking style.
Is that a new phenomenon? And is that real cooking? I mean, trying to recreate the taste of a cigarette in a sorbet, is that moving the ball forward? Is that important?
It does move the ball forward. It is important, I think, but at the same time, it's, you know, in a way, it's always a side story. The way cuisine masseur was, the way nouvelle cuisine was. For somebody who loves cooking, professionally, that is always intriguing and you learn from it and it changes your style a bit. But that particular molecular cuisine in the hands of four or five people in the world is genius and intriguing and wonderful. It's not everyday food. Unfortunately, that stuff is very difficult. So in the hands of somebody not that great, it's just rubbish. Mm-hmm. Like foam, for instance, you know, that from El Bulli in northern Spain. When he made, you know, a foam of, let's say, wild mushrooms, it was absolutely the pure essence, the smell, the taste. I mean, the whole thing is if you had a pound of fresh mushrooms on your plate, but it was a tablespoon of light, wonderful thing, you know, very easy on your body, but fully satisfying. Well, if somebody thinks they can put that in a can and pump it up with gas and shove it all over every plate they do, then they've made a big mistake.
Mm-hmm.
So it is very, very educational and very inspiring, but it's only for the hands of a very few people, and it's temporary.
We're on Pacifica Radio. It started in Berkeley, Pacifica Radio, and we're on KPFK in Los Angeles. Pacifica Radio, far left, beyond left. It's so left, we might as well be on the right. There's no difference anymore.
Sometimes they meet.
Yes, they do. So I lived in Berkeley in the 80s. I didn't go to Berkeley. I went for the revolution, the Sandinistas and stand-up comedy. And Chez Panisse is in Berkeley. I had a lot of friends who went to Berkeley. For students living on Top Ramen, Chez Panisse was where you ate if you were lucky enough to be rooming with somebody who had rich parents visiting from out of state. Talk to me about the politics behind Chez Panisse. It is an exclusive restaurant, and the incredible food notwithstanding, how do you square a world-class restaurant rising from the progressive movement's ground zero, Berkeley?
The revolutionaries from the left or the right, no one is ever so happy to get into that hotel suite or into a limousine as those people. I mean, look at, you know, Mao Zedong, look at Lenin, look at Talleyrand from the French Revolution. I mean, they invented a whole new fashion of men's clothes minutes after they got off the street.
The sans-culottes.
Sans-culottes, yeah. I mean, nobody wants to be cold and hungry, and if it involves, you know, 800 thread Egyptian cotton sheets, then so much the better.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, that, as you saw in the film, Last Magnificent, that was a bit of a problem. When I was not very Berkeley. Berkeley, when I first got there, I think it was a three or four course menu for $6.50. So that was 1972, but it still was only $6.50. When I took it at $7.50, because, you know, we had no money, we were going broke, there was practically another revolution in the streets because their favorite place was now an expensive restaurant. Seems ridiculous now when, you know, that the $7.50 will get you a glass of water in New York or Beverly Hills. So they saw that as a bit of a problem, but they also love to eat.
There is a phenomenon of people who leave San Francisco and resent it. Do you resent San Francisco? Do you think there's a work ethic there, or are people slaves to the lifestyle? Do you like what San Francisco has become, or is that an unfair question to ask you?
It's not an unfair question. It's actually a very clever one, because most people wouldn't even know that question exists, whether it's about me or any other people, as you say, who leave San Francisco. I've always found San Francisco a little bit difficult because it's so self-congratulatory.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, about the Bay. Well, excuse me, everybody. Have you seen Sydney Harbor? Have you seen Venice? You know, I mean, but Sydney Harbor, Hong Kong Harbor are much more exciting than the Bay in San Francisco. But of course, it is one of the most beautiful cities in the world, has a great food culture. It's just that one gets a little tired of hearing everyone say how fabulous it is.
Yeah, I lived there for 12 years. Is there a work ethic there? Was it hard to find people willing to sacrifice their lifestyle for the puritanical work ethic?
Well, yes, because if they didn't, they couldn't work at Stars. I mean, it was just clear.
Okay.
I mean, yes, it wasn't as difficult as you make it sound, but compared to Sydney, which I just did in terms of the beauty, I mean, I was doing a promotion for Stars at the Regent Hotel in Sydney, and the cooks, if the surf was up, they just didn't show up for work.
Wow.
Well, I was supposed to be swanning around the kitchen showing people this and that, and I ended up cooking two stations. It was amazing.
Well, you've been very generous with your time. I hope you come back. I have a theory about taking the job at Tavern on the Green. I think, like most people, you're a control freak, and it was your way of directing the movie. The Last Magnificent is an amazing documentary, and my theory is you took that job at Tavern on the Green because you figured the documentary didn't have a third act.
That's what the director thinks, but it's not true.
Jeremiah Towers' latest book is Table Manners, How to Behave in the Modern World and Why Bother, and go see The Last Magnificent. You were very generous with your time. Thank you so much, Jeremiah Tower.
Thank you very much, David, for inviting me on the show.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
This Saturday, tomorrow, April 29th, 7:30 p.m., at QED in Astoria, Queens, we will be doing a live taping of this show, of the David Feldman Show. Listen to this lineup of guests, folks. Comedian Sean Donnelly, who you've seen on Conan and Letterman, he will be a guest. Along with David Feldman Show regulars, Angela Cobb, you know him, and some of you hate him, Pat Dixon from the New York Crime Report. He kicked my ass in the roast battles, and I love Pat Dixon. He's incendiary. You don't want to miss this. Tickets are only $8. To purchase in advance, go to QEDAstoria.com and search for the David Feldman Show. I will personally shake everyone's hand after the show. I'm bringing Purell. Not for me, for you. You're going to want to clean your hands after you shake my paws, and you'll get a chance to see my hair plugs up close and personal. I will let you touch my hair plugs if you show up to QED. This is how desperate I am. On tomorrow, April 29th at 7:30 p.m. at QED in Astoria, Queens, if you come out to see me, I will let you touch. You can run your fingers through my lush and verdant hair plugs. Go to QEDAstoria.com. Search for the David Feldman Show. $8. And, if you know somebody who lives in Astoria but you're living overseas, buy them a ticket as a gift. $8. The more of you who show up, the more of these we will do.
You're nervous? That's a good sign.
No, I'm not really.
Oh, damn it. I was hoping you would.
I want to be good. I want to be good because I listen to a lot of podcasts and I'm thinking.
Joining us from San Francisco, Mill Valley. Are you in Mill Valley?
I am in Mill Valley right now as I speak to you.
In God's country, Mill Valley, Mark Pitta. Let me introduce Mark Pitta to my listeners. You might remember him from a couple of years ago. He played the Federal Reserve. We interviewed the Federal Reserve.
Mark Pitta as Al Pacino.
As Al Pacino. And I asked questions about the Fed, because you're not allowed to audit the Fed.
And you're not, and that's why he kept saying, I'll let you ask this one time. This one time, I will let you ask.
And you kept calling me Kate.
Okay.
Kate,
and then I like how he lies at the Godfather. He goes, did you? And he goes, no. The way he says no from that point on in his life forever. No.
Mark Pitta.
I hope he never dies because that's my best impression.
Mark Pitta and I started together in San Francisco. You are an empresario. You have been on all the television shows. You became a local hero on television in San Francisco. And mm-hmm. I have a bone to pick with San Francisco. This is my introduction. San Francisco.
Okay, great.
I'm going to trash San Francisco, and then I'm. I'm angry at San Francisco. I lived there for.
Why, David?
It cured me. It turned me into a man. It gave me everything I have. And then I left. And like everybody who leaves San Francisco, I resent it because it's so beautiful, so idyllic, and I can't go back there.
And you stepped off the pedestal that was created being successful in San Francisco to out in the real world where no one knew who you were. But you achieved many highlights of a career when you left. So don't shortchange yourself.
I know. But the thing about San Francisco, now on today's show, we have Jeremiah Tower. Remember Star's Restaurant?
Funny guy.
You're thinking of Jim Hightower. Tower, Star's Restaurant, Chez Panisse, he created modern American cuisine. And he left San Francisco as well and said, it's a little too proud of itself, San Francisco. And I have a problem with the comedy community, something you addressed and fixed, but it's too big. Mm-hmm. It's too big a problem now for you to fix it all by yourself. You created comedy at the Throckmorton Theater in Mill Valley, California. It is
11 years ago.
The best comedy room in the Bay Area. If you're visiting San Francisco, you have to go to Mill Valley. It's over the Golden Gate Bridge, and go see comedy at the Throckmorton. And hanging out there is Mark Pitta and Mort Saul.
There's a lot of famous comedians that have come through. And the reason it all started was because when I finished my TV morning show I had here for 5 years, I really missed comedy, but Live Nation owns the Punchline and Cobbs. I couldn't even get back into my home clubs. So I created a comedy night on Tuesday, and that was very strategic, as you know, because comedians are available on Tuesday. They're either done with their week or they're about to prepare to go for a new week. And it was one of those things that, hey, let's try a weekly show. But having Dana Carvey and Robin Williams as your friends, and they would show up, then a buzz was created. Then the audience thought they were going to maybe see Dana or Robin. But when they didn't, what was on stage was a lot of my friends who were hilarious that don't have TV shows or are not famous. And it became a really cool core comedy audience. So they weren't there to see the famous person. They were there to see comedy, which is exactly what we went through in the 80s. People just went out to see comedy.
Yeah. And it's still going strong. Woody Allen has played the Throckmorton as a musician.
He's told one joke. He says, you know, we love coming here and playing for you, but we do it anyway. It's like that old joke where a man comes home and his wife is in bed with his best friend, and he says, Phil, I have to, but you? So he's saying, we would play anyway, you know.
Woody
Allen speaks.
Go ahead.
That was so funny because I got to meet Woody Allen. I got to meet Woody Allen, and I have... Well, I say I have in my possession, but when you go through a divorce and you don't have your belongings yet, you may not have this item anymore. Anyway, if I could do it quickly, Take the Money and Run was shot in San Francisco. That was his first movie. I happen to have a neighbor who was in SAG, and he's in the famous scene where he tries to rob the bank and they can't read the note. Well, he ended up with the Gub note. You know, I have a gun on you. Is that Gub? You know, the famous scene. He ended up with it, and he showed it to me, and he actually had the note in Woody's handwriting. And when he passed away, I convinced his wife that he always wanted me to have that. So I framed it. Yeah, thank you. I framed it with the lobby card of everybody pointing at the note and my neighbor in the scene holding the note. And I had it framed, and I showed it to Woody Allen, and Woody Allen goes, thank you. And I said, I'm not giving it to you. And he turned into Woody Allen. He goes, you know, I'm sorry. You know, people give me things. I didn't mean to, you know, take for granted this is mine. So I have a Woody Allen story out of that. So that's cool.
That's great. Yeah. And were you there with Mort? Was it backstage at the Throckmorton?
That was actually, Woody and I were the only ones in the green room at that time. Wow. Mort performed earlier in the day, earlier in that evening. And my favorite thing was they're playing, and I go into the lobby, and Tommy Smothers is in the lobby.
Wow.
During the show. And I go, what's Tommy, what are you doing in the lobby? And he goes, it's like he's blowing a kid's whistle. That is the worst clarinet I've ever heard. And I said to Tommy, so now we're just talking about stuff. I go, what do you think of this whole Bill Cosby thing? And he goes, that guy's been like that forever. One time I hit him in his fist with my face. So Cosby's
whoa, yes.
Yep. Remember that?
Well, we never knew why. We never knew
why. I think Cosby thought he did a joke of his or something like that, you know, on the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour. Something along those lines.
But who would hit Tommy Smothers?
I don't know, but Tommy's... I mean, it was so much fun to talk to Tommy as an adult, you know, because you grow up watching him as a teenager. And one time I had the opportunity at dinner to talk to him. Listen to this dinner, David. Mort Saul, Robin Williams, Shelley Berman, Tommy Smothers, Sammy Hagar. I mean, you're like, what? And I was at the other end of the table, like, why am I sitting away from the legends? So I walk over to Tommy, and I go, before the entrees come, I go, Tommy, when you were at your height, I hope he doesn't mind me saying this, when you were at your height of the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour, who did you have sex with? He goes, Terry Garr.
Wow.
Oh, wow. She was really hot. He goes, and then one time, it was 6 months later, I was at a party and she was there. And I was trying to pick up on her and she looked at me and she goes, I knew you forgot. I'm sorry. I'm betraying his loyalty there and confidence that I would never repeat that. But when you're on the David Feldman podcast,
we get you. I gotta get you to spill your guts and make you cry. That's the whole purpose of this show.
I listen to a lot of podcasts, and I'm gonna just go against the grain here. I love Janine Garofalo. I don't know her that well. I think the last time I saw her was at the gym on Beverly Boulevard. We called it Butts on Beverly because they always had the Stairmasters facing the gym. So everybody on the Stairmaster, their butts were in the window. And I like Ginny because she would always call me by my full name. She goes, hello, Mark Pita. She would always say it like that. But a lot of the times on your show and other podcasts, people invariably will talk about, well, I haven't had a drink in 18 years. So I'm just letting you know, I am having wine during this podcast. I'm not much of a drinker, but I wanted to, if I get a little tipsy during the podcast, it makes for a better podcast. I used to do Monster Party. I do that one. That's Matt Weinhold, and he talks about Matt, horror films. And he always get you drunk on that show. So,
well, podcast edition. You're on the same episode with Jeremiah Tower, who is responsible for the snobbery of California cuisine. We can't imagine a time when people in Mill Valley and the Napa Valley didn't turn their nose up on other cuisine, but it's because of Jeremiah Tower and Chez Panisse.
They have Chez Panisse in Berkeley, right?
Yeah. So what kind of wine are you drinking?
Well, I like this one called Freak Show I did a gig in Lodi, and it was a Michael David winery, and they gave us a bottle, and I really enjoyed it. So it's called Freak Show. It's got, like, circus elephants on the label and stuff like that. If you still buy wine, I was surprised to know you lived in New York, David. If I could turn the tables and interview you, what brought you to New York? And I'm sorry if the listeners already know this, but I don't.
An airplane.
I didn't mean your mode of travel. I meant what spiritually brought you to New York.
I grew up in New York, and there was a marriage of a couple of decades that crumbled, and there was a job offer in New York, and I wanted to see my mommy. I get to hang out with my mother and my sister and friends who I grew up with.
Well, I never knew that. I guess because when I met you in San Francisco, I just assumed everybody was from there.
Did you really think I was from San Francisco? That's a compliment.
Well, I did think you were from there, because when I started, you were just one of the guys that went on stage like me, and I thought it was just all local guys. I didn't realize that Playboy article where Robin is quoted, and the whole article is about the Holy City Zoo. That was a beacon for comedians.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I must go to San Francisco. I read in Playboy, there's this small club. And they get there and they realize, wow, this is a small club.
I got to the Holy City Zoo. I'll talk about that Playboy interview in a second, but I got to the Holy City Zoo and I said, oh, this is fine. I'll give you my coat. Now, where's the club? I thought this was where the audience waited before we were seated. That Playboy interview, earlier in the week, we had Stephen Pearl on the show. And mm-hmm. I saved my first calendar, October of 1982. Stephen Pearl presents. It was me, Kurt Weldon. And somewhere in storage in Los Angeles is this framed calendar. Becky, Rebecca Irwin put me on. And taped to the calendar is a piece from that Playboy interview with Robin Williams. So it's the calendar, and then there's some, it's too personal for me to talk about it, but there is a quote that I cut out from Playboy from Robin that I glued to that calendar, and that is my penis. Everything flows from that.
Yeah.
Everything
all
I
the,
got.
All the blood goes there.
That everything I have in life is from the Holy City Zoo. That's where I became.
Well, don't you feel that when you're learning something new, like stand up, and you realize, wow, I might be good at this, that those are special times no matter where you started. A lot of mm-hmm. comedians have fond memories of Boston or Chicago.
Right.
But because, and don't you think that our group is so tight that we've never lost friendships, really, unless there was an argument. I don't want to mention the people who have passed, but Monty Hoffman. Anyway, I think that Monty was never a fan of mine, but I did like the guy. But this is a fraternity. You've been in the bunker together. It's like
right.
the San Francisco group in the 80s. So I'm still tight. I have Dan St. Paul, who was with Murphy St. Paul, Sue Murphy mm-hmm. at the time. I actually was recording something in the green room, and I have Dan and I meeting on audio tape.
Really?
And we've been friends ever since. He goes, hey, I used to do an impression of Dustin Hoffman, Al Pacino, and Robert De Niro in a movie called We're All Alike. And I just would quote their, you know, famous scenes. And he goes, hey, you look like those guys. I go, hey, what's your name? Dan. Hi, Dan. You know, it's just so weird. I've known him ever since that day.
What's interesting about, Mark Pitta, what's interesting about you, many things are interesting about you, because I want to talk about the history of the San Francisco comedy scene. You are one of those people who is hysterically funny. And at the same time, you love comedy. And you're also kind of a historian when it comes to the scene. You really genuinely love the comedy scene. You are a genuine...
I do,
You are.
I'm a little insulted by comedians now who don't even go back and look or hear. I was at the Great American Comedy Festival in Nebraska, in Johnny Carson's hometown, and that Eddie Brill puts on. And
did you ever meet Johnny?
I did, but I'll get to that in a minute. But I'm at the festival, and the person getting the Veterans Award was David Steinberg. David Steinberg.
I'm David Steinberg.
He did over 300 Tonight Show shots, right? So he's on stage with Eddie Brill, and Eddie's interviewing him. He's telling these great stories, and I go into the green room to get some water, and all the other comedians, the young ones, are on their phones. And I'm like, you're missing something.
Wow.
These stories he had was invaluable. My favorite, and I don't know if it's famous at this point, but he tells about directing B. Arthur in Golden Girls, his first directorial sitcom job. And he was told that B's very hard to work with. I'll shorten the story in that.
No,
he's hard to work.
Don't shorten. Just
well, he's okay. Well, he said that he would direct her like, "Hey, B, instead of saying that line there, why don't you cross the couch, sit down, and say the line?" And B. Arthur would say, "Why in God's name would I do that?" Well, it's just a suggestion, you know. So at the end of the week, she always takes her directors out for a drink because she knows she's hard to do with. So she's sitting with David Steinberg and says, David, why do people take an instant dislike to me? And David said, to save time? which is a fantastic ad-lib.
Right,
I mean,
right.
But and the young comedians are like not even listening to these great stories and like, oh, like, remember being on stage and hearing another comedian, I think it was Don Ware, he was basically doing Cosby.
Cosby, yeah.
And you're like,
yeah.
Yeah, it's like, what's going on, you know? It's like, we know what you're doing, so.
Well, Larry Miller, remember Larry Miller, the great, one of the greatest comics?
Mm-hmm. Larry Miller.
Larry
yeah.
Miller.
And right. You hit 70, yeah.
Mm-hmm. One of the greatest comics ever. Ever. Early on, he was a little like Robert Klein. I remember. Do you remember that?
Robert Klein was definitely an influence on him, yes.
Yeah. And then eventually he broke away from that. And I remember looking at Larry going, well, he's kind of been influenced a little too much by Robert Klein. And then he mm-hmm. broke free of Robert Klein. And I would say, I don't know why I'm talking about Larry Miller, other than Don Ware was kind of doing Bill Cosby, although I don't think he was doing the thing.
I think one time I remember this.
I don't want to gossip.
I witnessed this. He said on stage, my brother, and I think I yelled out, Russell, because it was just too close, you know. My brother Russell, because I'll come in the room when the guy's in the plate. And you go, well, then you give him the pill, and you go crazy. He wakes up, and I got a robot. Is that the weirdest thing, though, that Mort Saul told me that Bill Cosby was always kind of an angry guy? It's kind of sad when your heroes are, like, torn down so quickly, but...
Let me ask you a
question. I can't think of any other way at this point.
I asked this of Robert Smigel and Gilbert Gottfried, and I'm going to ask you the same question.
Okay.
The three of you do a perfect Bill Cosby. How do you not talk like that all day? If I could do that, I would just talk that way all day. How do you stop?
I think the Al Pacino is harder for me to stop, to be honest with you, because you can go to Starbucks and order like him, and you get it right away because it's very intimidating. I like a tall, non-fat, healthy fuck. You know, you get it immediately, right? But if you go Cosby ordering coffee, it's not.
Let me.
Well, the thing is the water, but the water not too hot. You think? Yeah. It's fun. I feel like a parrot sometimes. You know, the challenge is to come up with somebody new, and I've been trying just to do somebody new. I was thinking of Mandy Patinkin.
Yeah.
From Homeland.
Uh huh.
And this is the only impression I have. It's really short. Previously on Homeland. That's basically it. That's all I got. I love your laugh, David. I think your listeners do too.
People say to me, you always praise your guests and you always, you know, you laugh. Yeah, I wouldn't have, why would I be doing this if I didn't have funny people? I'm not going to put on somebody, you know, it's not like I'm, anyway, but
you don't have to fake laugh either. Now, because you've been successful, and by the way, it's my opportunity to tell you how proud I am of you. I think the last time I saw you in San Francisco, you were writing for Marty Short. His Broadway homage to myself, was it called? Or no?
Fame Becomes Me. Fame Becomes Me.
Yeah. And we saw you outside, my wife and I at the time. Jeez, I got to say, at the time now.
Mm-hmm.
We saw you, and I was just happy. I don't know if you remember this, but you were writing for his character, the old-time...
Irving Cohen.
Showman, Irving Cohen.
Give me a B, I don't know if you remember this. B.
Give me a bouncy C, right. So you were writing one-liners for that, right? So do you remember this? That we were in the theater. I'm like in row 10, but you're like in row 25. And he does this joke that bombs, and you laugh. And Marty breaks character, in character, says, is that you, Feldman? And then there were two other people laughing because we were the only person in the theater that knew what was going on. But that's how flexible that guy was. Yeah,
yeah. He would. Is that you? And, or I told you that Feldman. Wouldn't work, Feldman. I told you, Feldman, that wouldn't work.
Now that I've brought you up and complimented you,
yes.
One of the things I have on my YouTube channel is a KPIX news report on the rising stars of stand up comedy, and they have footage of you just eating it.
Oh wait, hang on, you're wrong. You got two things wrong there.
Okay.
First of all, I didn't eat it. I completely bombed and tanked it. And it wasn't KPIX. It was KRON.
KRON. Shannon, right?
Wayne Shannon, yes.
Wayne Shannon. And are you sure? Because there might have been, there was a lot of news coverage at the time. Okay.
I'm absolutely.
Because you're on stage at the zoo and you're saying something about evolution and you basically just end up, because it's on there, you say, well, yeah, evolution is not funny. Evolution. And you just kind of like, you just kind of bury it and move on. But that's, it sucked because that's all they showed of you at that point.
Well, you, this, you have on tape your meeting Dan St. Paul. You have always been a collector of the San Francisco comedy scene.
I was supposed to be the guy who wrote the, I was going to write a book about it, and everybody goes, oh, you got to do a documentary, and then you got in there, we start losing people. But I have like the final interviews of Jose Simone, of John Cantu. You know, people like that. I have them, and I transcribed them, but I just didn't know how to work it into a book. So I think,
why don't you do a podcast?
I have one book. I was thinking of just, instead of doing a documentary, just doing a web series of the stories. Mm-hmm. You know, that way you could put a little history in there. But
the San Francisco.
I did meet Johnny Carson. I want to go back to Johnny Carson for a second because you didn't mention that. When I did his show, of course, I met him after, and. The thing about my appearance was when I finished, I walked back to the curtain. Curtain opens, and I walked right through, and I thought, man, something's missing. I never looked at Johnny to get the okay sign from him. I just was, I don't know why, I just froze. And then when I meet him, I go, God, I waited my whole life to get the okay sign. He goes, I was trying to give it to you. You didn't look back. but if you look at that, he actually goes out of his way to mouth, great shot or funny stuff. You know, he made sure people knew why he liked me. Wow. And then I said, I waited my whole life to get the, I was trying to give it to you. And then I shake his hand, he leaves. And then 2 minutes later, he comes back and he goes, I hope you come back.
Wow.
And I wanted to say, I have my calendar right here. And then Jim McCauley, who booked the comics, was really into giving people their first shots when he announced retirement. So I never got to go back. I did it with Jay Leno, but Jay Leno was easy to do. You know, I work with him on the road, so it's like, you know, you're doing his show, wasn't that special?
They're doing Johnny with Jay.
That is weird. You know what? Do you have in New York antenna TV where they replay Johnny Carson shows at 11 o'clock?
Mm-hmm.
They don't have that in the Bay Area. It went Spanish all of a sudden. We don't get those, but those were great to watch. You see guys' first shots, you know, that, you know, now you're friends. And you're from the future because Robert Blake is sitting there and you're like, oh, I know what's going to happen to him. You know, it's like, I'm from the future when that show comes up.
I wish I smoked dope because I used to smoke dope and watch Johnny Carson and would be, I know that if I were smoking dope now, I could feel like I'm in the future. I know I could transport myself back to the early 80s or the late 70s, convince myself that it's the set and I'm from the future. I've been watching old Rickles. The San Francisco.
Me too. I wrote a song about Rickles. I was so upset and I was so inspired that I wrote a song and I performed it at the Throckmorton on two Tuesdays ago. And I put it on YouTube. And I put it on Twitter, and I called Kevin Pollak, and I said, Kevin, I got 7 followers. I just got back to Twitter. Could you share this song about Rickles? And he does, and like by the end of the day, I have 500 hits or 400 hits. And then I sent one to Mindy Rickles, his daughter, and there's two versions. One is live, where I do Rickles during to the tune of Hallelujah, Leonard Cohen's song. And
You sang Hallelujah as Don.
I would say things like Hallelujah. Now, how much did you weigh, Tiny? You know, do Rickles lines, you know, like Hallelujah. Is that your wife? Jesus, you know. But there's another version I did where I actually dropped in Rickles during the Hallelujahs, and I only had 1.9 seconds because, you know, that was the space I had to deal with. And he talked really fast, so I got them all in. But yeah, you know, you lose guys like Rickles. That's why I like to pay tribute, you know, because people don't know who these comics are. He's, you know, he was doing it till the end.
He was doing it to the end.
That leaves me this question to you. How do you want to go out, David?
Why, do you know something I don't know?
No, but I was thinking of Dick Shawn. I'm like, that could be kind of cool, dying right on stage. You know, that could be kind of interesting.
Dick Shawn from The Producers, comedian, died in the mid-80s. People thought it was part of his act, right?
His son was in the audience and knew something was up. He was the only one. He ran on stage, yeah.
But, to me, stand-up comedy and comedy is such a denial of death. And I just can't imagine it. And I don't like to, I just don't like to think about it. I just don't. Okay, you know what I noticed about Mill Valley, though? There's a lot of talk.
That was almost a Leno impression.
You know what I noticed about Mill Valley? You know what I noticed? I noticed that when you guys hang out. I can't do impressions. You know, I can do impressions around, for me doing impressions, I can do it around loved ones. Not that you're not.
So those two people really. Okay.
it requires me to be totally uninhibited. And I've worked, you know, it's like to do an impression around you is. But you know who gave me courage to do impressions is Robin, because Robin, you know, I can't even talk about him. And I'll see clips of him to this day and go. And still be a little envious, you know, just go like. But he was not an amazing impressionist, which made him even funnier. It was just, you know what I mean? Like I remember watching him do Ed Sullivan, laughing my ass off and going, well, that doesn't even sound like Ed Sullivan, which made it
he
even.
He did the essence. He did like the essence of a lot of people, but he never sat and probably worked on an impression like some of us do. Yeah.
Which made him that makes him even more miraculous. Where and Dana, I don't want to get into this conversation. Dana, anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, no, Dana, you finished that because Dana loves the abstract. Once he nails an impression, he abstracts it to the point of, like, you know, Bush never said not going to do it. Dana did, and not going to do it. Eventually becomes not get that. Just exaggerated, so he thought it was funny. I don't work on a lot of impressions, but my favorite one, and no one does, not even Kevin Pollak, is Robert Duvall. And one time I was talking to a friend of mine who is like a second cousin of the great author Pat Conroy. Now, I read all of Pat Conroy's books, and when he passed away, I said to my Eleanor, my friend, said, I wish I would have met him. And she goes, you did. You were with me. We went to Pasadena when he was signing book Beach Music. And you did Robert Duvall for him from the Grand Santini. And I'm like, oh, that's right. And I flashed. I'm like, that's right. I went up to him. I did. Remember the Grand Santini?
Of course.
With Robert Duvall, like, you know, what does he say? Like, number 23 goes down. You don't come home. You're my sweetest little girl. And he said, I remember he said, put that on video and send it to me. So I did get to meet him, but that's my favorite one.
You're going
to
cry, too? You're going to cry? You're going to cry?
You can't gun down New York City police, Captain Sonny. The five families will come after us. The Connolly family will be outcast.
That's incredible.
I saw him once at the Four Seasons bar, and I just froze. Do you ever like to meet famous people? I always like to be introduced to them. I never want to be the guy that goes, hi, I'm Mark, you know. You come in contact with a lot of famous people.
I want to ask you a question about impressions. When you're when you're hanging out with Robin and Dana and Pearl, do you guys just lock into, like, is it conceivable that you will spend the entire day talking like Bill Cosby?
No, but that I'm glad you asked that. I was with Dana and. Hey, Dana, throw on Grizzly Man. Okay, the Werner Herzog documentary about the guy who lives with the bears. But Werner Herzog narrates it. And so I start talking like Herzog, then Dana starts talking like Herzog. Okay, we would not stop because the guy had that, like, you know, Treadwell thought the bears were nice, the cuddly kind with the buttons for the eyes, but they thought of him as dinner. But you have to say the word bears. Mm-hmm. And then we're watching the Beatles documentary 8 days a week by Ron Howard, and during that I go, what would Werner Herzog say about this, Dana? And Dana goes, even though Ringo would stand up to drum, but he could not compete with Paul's cuteness. You know, that we just, that would be hours of doing that. It's just for fun. Then no one's going to, like, where's the next Werner Herzog impression? Nobody cares. But that's one of the fun things about hanging with comedians. You could just riff without a podcast being recorded or without a documentary filmmaker, just having fun.
Right. Right. I guess maybe because I'm afraid of doing Cosby and not being able to turn it off. I really think if I could talk like Bill Cosby, I know this sounds insane, but if I could do that, there's a reason I cannot do Cosby. Do you have to study? I mean, how do you do it?
I think it's like a person who can sing on key. We have an ear for music. We have an ear for impressions. And you know what? Now that you say that, it did happen with Dana. Again, we were driving to a casino right outside the border of Utah, and Dana's talking to the driver, and he goes, who was here last? And they said, Bill Cosby. And Bill Cosby finds out that Dana's coming next, and he goes, call me later and tell me how the boy draws. Like, he's got like a competition to go. So we would just do Cosby the whole time. If the guy doesn't draw, you call me on the phone. You make sure you tell me that there's five seats that are empty. But of course, it's a road trip too, so we're bored and we're just doing. And I heard that Cosby had to have cookies by his. He wouldn't sleep in the hotel room. He would sleep in the meet and greet room on the couch because he didn't like the colors in his room, and he would have to have like 15 chocolate chip cookies outside his door with milk, and he would know there's only 13 cookies. You know, it's like all these eccentric things you find out about people. It's like the Albert Brooks story.
Well, hang on for 1 second. Hang on. You know, I've heard a lot of things about Bill Cosby in the past couple of years, but this cookie story, you know what? I cannot watch.
You broke it.
Yeah, that's it. Now I'm done with
it. Famous story. Albert Brooks's wife's mother lives in Mill Valley, so they were here for some kind of birthday for her. And Mort Saul was playing the Throckmorton.
Jesus Christ. Hang on for 1 second. Everybody's got to go to the Throckmorton in Mill Valley. I haven't been there in a couple of years, but I do remember it being like that. I just remember going, you too? What's Rob Reiner doing? You know, that it was just.
I know. It's crazy.
Go ahead.
I remember you on stage there. You were creating such tension leading to this pedophile joke, and you could just see the sphincters closing and people. And you broke them by saying, God, I hope this is funny at the end. You know, it broke everybody up. But that's the essence of comedy. You create this tension and then release the tension.
Right.
And you did it with an ad lib, but it's like people were like, don't do it. We're all parents here.
Right.
But so getting back to Albert Brooks walks over to the theater because Mort Saul is playing that particular night.
Jesus.
I'm upstairs in the balcony, and then I go down to the green room after the show, and Albert walks in. I'm like, holy cow. The reason I'm doing comedy just walked in the room, and I'd met him before, but he was hilarious in the green room, and it turns out that he's great in green rooms and parties, but he doesn't want to go on stage anymore. But there's this famous story of Rob Reiner's party, and Albert's holding court for like 20 minutes and breaking everybody up, and he kind of says, oh, thank you, good night, and he goes to the next room. 2 hours go by, Rob's saying goodbye to somebody at the door, and in the bushes he hears, Rob, what? It's Albert. What are you doing? I left my coat in there, but I did so well, I didn't want to go back. Now that's fucked up.
He is very interesting in that he started doing the Tonight Show. Now think about this for a second. You did the Tonight Show with Johnny, right?
Yes, I did. That is correct.
And is Bill Cosby there? Bill, are you?
I did the Tonight Show when I was a young man and a pervert.
And how many weeks did it take you, Bill Cosby, to prepare for your Carson shot?
I don't remember how many weeks because I played the Vegas and I played Tahoe when I played Atlantic City and I came back and I did a couple.
All right, so it was a big thing for you. Well, Albert Brooks, Bill, was never performed in front of an audience. He performed at
Rob Reiner.
No, I never did that. No, I did it on the phone for my friends, and I knew it was funny. That's what Albert would do. He would call his friends, and if they laughed, he knew it was funny, and he'd do it on the show.
And Rob Reiner, Carl Reiner, the father, said to Johnny Carson, you have to have this guy on your show. And Albert Brooks went from somebody's living room into 40 million living rooms.
I read that part in Carl Reiner's book about Albert as a teenager doing Houdini's Son, and all he has around his wrist is this thin little, I'm probably not saying this right, he's held his wrist together by a piece of string barely made into a loop to hold it there, and he goes behind a curtain and he cannot get it off as Houdini's Son. It's this whole thing like, this is thing, I'll be with you in a minute, you know, it's just, you gotta read Carl Reiner's book on that, but Albert was very conceptual.
What's interesting about just going from a living room or calling your friends and then just going directly to The Tonight Show, we have Jeremiah Tower on the show today, and he was talking about absolute taste. You know how musicians have absolute pitch? He has absolute taste. And he wrote a cookbook with all the ingredients and how to prepare the meals without ever testing it. And I remember Dennis Miller getting a special ready. And I said, where are you doing this? And he said, Faldo, I don't need to test it in front of an audience. I'm not a hack like you. If I think it's funny, it's funny. And then he...
Christ, Feldman, if I thought I had to do that, I'd been out of the business back in the...
That is genius, where you can just...
Yeah,
Know it already.
Well, have you ever written a joke and you laugh and this is going to kill and then it doesn't? You're just shocked.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, I do a joke in my act I don't even like and it gets a big laugh. I go, I don't know why this is funny. But yeah.
In 2006, I wrote the greatest joke ever. Jerry Lewis had a birthday today. He's 80. Right? I go, and I did it backstage at the Ice House. I came up with it at the Ice House. Yeah. And everybody was going, that's amazing. That's going to kill. It was one of their anniversary shows. And I opened with it. He's 80. Nothing.
This sounds like Lady. Yeah.
I know. But no, and somebody said to me, well, he's 80, which means most of the people in your audience don't know about Lady. They don't know. Yeah.
I know. How famous do you have to be? You ever see the footage of Martin and Lewis throwing their autographs down to 53rd Street? And you're just, it's like the Beatles. It was just packed. How do you get to be that famous? That's why I think Jerry today has the right to be curmudgeon-y about stand up and all it's because he was that famous. You can't.
Well, I've told you this. I opened for you, David Schubert and I opened for you. You in the Bay Area. This was when we were all single. The women, it felt like a Hard Day's Night. It really did. The women were chasing after you, and we had to go from the green room to a restaurant in Old Sacramento. And we had a run, and I felt they weren't running after. I felt like Ringo, and you were Paul. We were running away from female fans. What is that like to actually
cue
do
the
it?
Band?
Huh?
Cue the band. Yeah. Those were the days.
Well, let me ask Bill Cosby that question. We have Bill Cosby on the line. Bill, are you there?
He left. He left the room.
I was going to ask him what it's like to have women just. Like, just fall all over.
They don't really fall over me because the water I give them first makes them a little hazy.
You know, I don't want to quote other comedians without giving them credit, but Dana Carvey has a great joke on Cosby. He goes, what if he just was old and he just got the order wrong? Do I give her the pill and then touch the titty, or I touch the titty and give her the pill? Dana Carvey. Quoting Dana Carvey.
Gosh. Usually because I appreciate that, but at the time, now you probably, you know, I never dated in high school. I had one girlfriend in high school for 3 weeks and that was it.
So I didn't know until I got into comedy that when I got off and I do jokes about being single, I would get off stage and then women would approach me. And then I started hanging out by the door when they left. Hi, good to see you. Thanks for coming. So one girl would say, like, wow, you're cute. I go, would you like a drink? And then I got the confidence to pick up women.
But back then it was just amazing. It was fun. But I don't know how to even answer that other than it was new to me and I took advantage of it.
Yeah. That must be, you know, my mind is wandering to a time when the women who walked up to comics after a show weren't crazy.
One comedian, I remember, I won't say his name, but he turned down the girl because he was sore. That's how much he was getting at the time. Ouch.
There was a time when, and I'm not, maybe it's an age. There was a time when we were starting at that the women who were attracted, not to you, you're a whole different other story. I mean, but okay. there were women who were attracted to regular comedians and they weren't crazy. As you get older, the women who are attracted to, that's not true.
Something about my instinct. Like, why did I pick that person when they turned out so strange? Was it me? Am I not judging people correctly? But I had a female friend. I have one of those friends that is female, but she's like a guy in that I could tell her anything and there's no sexual tension or anything. And she said, well, when you're with a woman, they all want to think you're in love with them. So if you go in with that premise, that would probably prepare you for when things get a little weird, get a little on.
Stay on that for 1 second. So women think you're in love with them, or they want you to be.
Women
in love with them?
Want you to think that women want to think you're in love with them. So, eventually.
Okay. And does that?
That's what my female friend said.
And are they in love with you?
That's the part where, well, you know, you're talking to a guy that's going through a divorce, and I thought my wife was in love with me, and you go like, if someone's in love with you, how could they act that way later? You know, so it's kind of sad. I wish her the best, you know, but
do you think men, yeah, I know the answer to this question, men need women more than women need men. Is that a fair statement?
I wish it wasn't that way.
But is that true? Yeah. That's true, right?
I think so. I think it has to do with men want to be validated by the opposite sex if they're heterosexual, you know.
Right.
So.
And what are women?
Some men need other men, and some women need other women. So.
Yeah, but what do women want?
That's a book. Isn't that the title of a book?
Yeah, but what do they want?
Mort Saul would say men want the love and women want the, I don't know, that old fashioned protection security thing. Does that still exist with women wanting and achieving heights of like, you know, David, bail me out on this.
Mort Saul, the father of modern.
Mort loves love.
Right, he's a romantic.
So, yeah, very much so. Every movie he's ever written is about love, and yeah, that's where he goes from. Yeah,
and yet his comedy is politics and love of America, and he gets up
and movies. He loves movies. That's where Mort and I bonded. I'm not very political, so we bonded with movies. Like the other day, I was with him, and I said, "Have you ever seen my Darling Clementine?" And he doesn't say yes or no. He just starts quoting it. Henry Fonda walks in and says, the bartender, are you married? He goes, nope, I've been a bartender my whole life. And he just has these clips, these little tiny pockets of dialogue he remembers. And then I would throw him a couple. So he likes me because we both like TCM. But yeah, he loves love. And he, you know, right now he's turning 90 and he's like, where are they? Where are these women I married that, you know, vowed to be in love with me? He's still disappointed. His first wife was interviewed for this. This biography is coming out about Mort on May 1st. I don't know when people are listening to this. And I haven't read it yet, so I don't know what his first wife says. But Mort goes, yeah. My first wife said, every day married to Mort was a nightmare. And Mort said, even the shopping? So he still has... Wow. He's still got his guns loaded.
somebody should do a movie. I mean, he was Mort. Wow, going to Mill Valley and just hanging out with you and Mort Saul. Wow.
Well, if you want to see Mort every Thursday, he's on Periscope at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, and through Twitter as well. So people ask questions through Twitter, and you'll be watching Mort, and all of a sudden Albert Brooks will come on, or Judd Apatow, or Alec Baldwin. These people are really, they wow. love to listen to them. But there's something to be said for living that long. You have to have more knowledge than everybody else, you know, and so he's still quick.
On Twitter, is it Mort Saul Says on Twitter?
Yes. Yes, and on the 7 o'clock, you could click that and go right to Periscope. I just go right to Periscope. Like the other day, I was sitting there, actually was sitting there watching it. And, you know, everybody wants to talk about Lenny Bruce because he's, you know, he's the Messiah. And
but it's Mort.
Like
it's Mort. But it's Mort. Mort, Mort,
really
Mort.
Really is Mort.
It's
yeah.
Mort. Mort. Mort is everything. Mort is the text of comedy. It all begins with Mort Saul. It just does.
It really does. Because that style still exists today.
And it holds up. If you go back and listen to him from the 50s, it's amazing.
He has a great joke, and I don't know if it's going to translate now, but when he was at the Carlisle in New York, and Dick Cavett introduced him, I was in the audience, and then he takes questions from the audience. Now, I kind of set him up because I just like the joke. I go, what is your favorite political movie? And he goes, 3 Days of the Condor. At the end, Redford is there, Cliff Robertson. They're right at that building. They're at the New York Times building. And he says, I told them a story. And Cliff Robertson says, and this is the joke, he goes, now everybody on the East Side is going to know. It's just a joke about who reads the Post and who reads the, you know.
Yeah. Now everybody on the Upper East Side is going to, yeah.
Yeah, I was at dinner with Mort recently, and he sneezed violently twice. You know, those big sneezes. And I said, that really shakes you up, doesn't it? Mort says, that's the closest to death I've been all day. Because he knows that when you sneeze, everything stops for a split second. Your heart, everything.
Does it really?
Yeah, that's why it's a brilliant joke. I just thought it was funny, too, the way you did. I'm like, oh, yeah, that's true. They say that everything stops for a second. Yeah. Anyway.
Maybe that's why it feels so good.
Don't you feel grateful that you're in a business where you get to meet and hang with people like this? Like the fact that I got to know Robin Williams the last 10 years of doing the Throckmorton, I saw him every week. I would have coffee with Mort and Robin at Pete's in Tiburon. And you're like, what? Did I ever think this was going to happen? And because I used to hang around ball players, I know not to be nervous around them. I'd just be cool, you know. And that was insane. And then I got to meet, like, when Robert Klein was here. He's here because I go, I would like to see Robert Klein. So we just booked him. And he did an hour 45 on stage. And I'm not lying. 2 hours in the green room. Just really? Holding court with comedians. Oh, yeah. Telling great stories.
Wow.
So, and I got to meet George Carlin. And I got to meet Rickles once. And he did a Rickles to me, but not insulting me. I said, hey, Don, I'm Mark. I'm friends with Kevin Pollak. You guys are in Casino together. And he goes, Pollak, he doesn't know who he is. Always different voices. Pain in the ass. And I thought, okay, I got a little Rickles. And we were at Pixar, and he was doing the voiceover for Mr. Potato Head for a particular Oscar ceremony where they're under the seats, Mr. and Mrs. Potato Head under the seats, and they have to talk about best actress. So this is Don doing his VO. Mm-hmm. And this is exactly how he did it. He couldn't say Gwyneth Paltrow. Yeah, there's a lot of good actresses. That good actress, that Gwyneth Paltrow. Oh, geez, I hope she doesn't win. I got to see Don being Don, which is fantastic.
Uh-huh. I met Don. I met
Steve
Don.
Martin. Oh, good.
I met
it
Don.
What's your story?
My story is very quickly, because I've told it a million times on this show, is I made a bad joke, and he says, only Jew in the room, and he ain't funny. And I went down.
When he passed, that's it. There is nobody now that will ever say what we feel.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
When I wrote that song about him, one of the lines was about being PC and how he stuck by what he did. And the audience that paid already knew what they were going to get. So you don't go there being shocked. You go there hoping to hear what you want to hear.
Saying what you feel. That's so interesting. Saying what you feel, addressing the elephant in the room. That's what he did. That's what that was so amazing to watch him, especially on Carson. It was totally in the moment. He would pick up whatever the energy was and address it. Not really saying anything quotable. He would address the energy that was right in front of everybody.
Yeah, he was dialed in. My favorite one is on YouTube now. Him and Glenn Campbell and Dom DeLuise.
Uh huh. Yep.
Dom was talking about a.
And Glenn Campbell can't keep his mouth shut.
And Glenn Campbell, I think, is drunk or something. Mm-hmm. But but when he says, you know, I'll just cut to the chase. Don Rickles says about his wife. My wife just goes in the bedroom and goes, got a minute? And there's this pause, and you see Johnny, and Johnny already knows what he's going to say, and he's holding. And then Johnny says, well, at least your wife knows about your stamina. You know, and it's just like, or, you know, your staying power. Your staying power. And you're like, man, you cannot get this on TV anymore. Why? Because nobody moves down on the couch one. You had this dynamic of Peter Fonda sitting next to Gore Vidal, and you're like, how is that ever going to happen again? And I miss that when nobody stays on the couch anymore.
Why don't they stay on the couch anymore?
What is that? I don't understand. Where do they have to go? It's only 20 minutes left in the show, you know? Let's have Lady Gaga sitting next to, you know, Ronnie Lott or Al Pacino. It's just, there's something that could happen from that, you know?
Everybody,
why are we running Hollywood, David?
I think everybody is a star, and everybody is controlled by a publicist who is going overboard to protect their client. And so they become like mobsters, and they'll just say, now they'll say, no, Glenn Campbell can't stay while Don Rickles is, Glenn has to leave. You know, we're doing you a favor, and you can only have Glenn for 20 minutes. That's how it works these days.
You're going to have to answer for Santino, Carlo. Yeah, sorry. By the way, now Al Pacino as Michael at the end of Godfather says to Carlo, Pacini's dead, Tataya's dead. Today I handle all family business, so I have to. Who approached you? Was it Tataya or Pacini? Why does Carlo answer? They're already dead. He's not going to get any confirmation. As soon as he says one of the names, he's dead. So, like, I don't know. He just said, I don't know. He's so fucking.
How many times?
Wow, how did I get on the Carlo rant?
Well, no, because I've had to give up The Godfather for 3 years. I have not watched I was watching it every night on my phone. And when you watch it on your phone, you see everything. People say, how can you watch The Godfather on your phone? I said, no. When you watch it on your phone, you can see every shot and you begin to see continuity problems. You begin to see, you know, if you watch The Godfather 5,000 times every night, it doesn't hold up.
Well, we all know that Sonny misses punching Carlo about a mile. You know, he's a foot away. We know that. But continuity problems are all throughout movie history. I like movie mistakes that are just specific. Like my favorite one is North by Northwest, where Eve Marie Saint shoots Cary Grant in the United Nations cafeteria, and it's this shocking thing. She pulls a gun out and shoots him, and it's shocking to everybody, but the kid in the blue shirt dead center, right before she shoots him, he puts his fingers in his ears because it's probably take number 6. and it's dead center, so you can't miss this kid. It's hysterical.
That's interesting.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Speaking
my
of
favorite one also is, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, there's a huge continuity problem in The Godfather. It's called Godfather 3.
Okay.
That's the continuity problem. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
There are parts of 3 I like. So.
I know. Me too.
But, you know, it was Winona Ryder in that role, and she got a nervous breakdown, and Sophia Coppola stepped in.
Hey, there are parts of Godfather 3 that I think about all the time. There are actual scenes, you know, especially the Vatican banking story. And I always thought George Hamilton was underutilized in that movie. It's like probably George Hamilton's best role. The idea that they would have him as a consigliere was genius.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, it was sad though that, you know, Duvall wanted the same billing, the same money. You know, what are you going to do? I don't like that when sequels do that, but it's like with soap operas. Now the role of Thomas we've played by, you know, like, what? So let me ask you one more question before we wrap this up, and that is, have you ever written a treatment for
yes.
a film?
Yeah.
Okay. Is there a secret to it? I've been approached to write one, and I actually signed up, and it's only $90. I signed up for the David Mamet Masterclass. Because I just need a little guidance. I have this great idea. I've already pitched it. The people are really excited, but they need it on paper and, you know, register with the guild and all that. You don't want it stolen. But I don't know how to write one.
Go get Final Draft. It's a okay. screenwriting program.
Right.
And they have, within there, there's an application for treatments. And once you see the structure... And it's uh-huh. they have the template. You just start filling it in, and
okay,
yeah, and you know the log line, and then it's
okay,
and yeah. What do I know about movies? I don't know.
Well, it's actually I was really inspired by a Feud, the Betty Davis Joan Crawford thing on FX. I'm like, gee, I always want to see a movie about blank. I don't want to say it because you know mm-hmm. I'm doing it. And it's a biopic, but the person who owns the rights loves the idea.
Right. Now, and, does Steve Harvey, does he host that FX series?
No, it's one of the ones he doesn't. I think it's just...
Yeah. Mark Pitta.
David Feldman.
We just scratched the surface. We really did, because you're right. We have to wrap it up. There is a history to San Francisco. So many great... comedians came out of San Francisco, you know,
and were drawn to San Francisco. Yeah,
you know, there's
Ellen DeGeneres from New Orleans, you know, A. Whitney Brown, Kevin Pollak. Well, of course, that was San Jose, but you know, the Solomita brothers from Boston, you know, it was just
Kevin Meaney, Dana Gould, Dana Carvey, Jake Johansson, Robin Williams, Paula Poundstone. Whoopi Goldberg, and it goes on and on, and then it kind of stops. Kamau Bell,
mm-hmm.
Kevin Avery,
Kamau Bell, right? You could say, you know, who I saw at the Throckmorton who ate it,
Mark Curry.
She knew she ate it, yeah, Mark Curry. There's this woman named Ali Wong that I've seen her progress. From when she started and now she has like, I think something, you know, on Netflix, and you're like, I love watching people grow. And then it's sad to see when a person is, every time they're on stage, they do word for word what they did last time. Mm-hmm. So they're not working on their act, obviously, but it is fun to see the progression of people. And
Ali Wong is coming to New York. Jeff Wills just
yes,
posted.
Yes, that's the one.
Yeah. Yeah. And she's that big, huh?
Yeah, and she's really, I mean, you know, it was she bombed, and then the next time you could saw all the work she put into it, and she killed and controlled the crowd, and it was, yeah.
Well, how long has she been doing it?
I want to say like 8 years.
Wow.
To guess.
Do you see Jeff Wills at all?
Never.
Yeah, I never see him either. I should have him on this show, right?
He would have some stories.
Boy, when you talk about, this is a guy... who took a job at Fox, not Fox, 20th Century Fox, John and Ann Fox, booking the punchline. he booked the punchline and yeah. turned that into the biggest comedy booking franchise in the world. I mean, he's Live Nation. He created, before Jeff Wills, comics didn't play theaters.
Yeah.
Right?
Do you remember when the punchline, if you went through the kitchen, you're connected to the old Waldorf, which was another Bill Graham club, mm-hmm. rock and roll. And I'm emceeing, it's me, Carrie Snow, and Bobby Slayton. Now, Bob Fisher, who kind of looked like a young Harvey Keitel, was the doorman. And he goes, and I get off stage, I bring up Carrie, and Bob goes, you know, Roy Orbison's next door. I go, can I go see some of that? Yeah. So I go through the kitchen, I'm watching Roy Orbison sing Pretty Woman, Leah, and then I'm going to leave In Dreams, and then he sings, you know, Running Scared. I'm like, oh, I got to watch Running Scared, you know. And then I go through the kitchen back to the punchline, and Bob Fisher is on stage introducing Bobby Slayton because I stayed a little too long at the concert. But that's how much fun it was back then. You could sneak in. Paul Prudhomme came. Bill Graham brought him, you know, tying all this, you know, taste about food into your podcast. He came. He was the first guy to bring Paul Prudhomme, and we remember – there was this big thing of the old Waldorf, but the comics were eating alligator soup because they sent some over, you know?
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. I know.
Well, let's
man, I can't believe I tied up your previous guest with my portion.
Mark Pitta, how do people get in touch with you?
415-25 I need work. I don't know. Just Google.
Do you have a Twitter handle?
Mark. Yeah, I'm Road Comic 3, and I'm on Facebook. But I only, you know what I did on Facebook? Is I only friend people I've met, because when I'm reading about people on Facebook, I want to know the person. So I don't want just to read 50 things from people I don't know. So, but yeah, Twitter, I have very few followers. I went off for a couple of years and came back on. But go to my YouTube page. I have a lot of fun videos I post if you like comedy. Great. And you can see David Feldman talking about evolution.
Wow. Mark Pitta, it's been too long.
I miss you.
I miss you too.
The good thing is about pot. You know, when I listen to you talking to Larry, it's like, well, you're in the room with me. So it feels good to have friends back.
Yeah.
You know?
Stay on the line. Hang on for 1 second. Thank you, Mark.
Hey, my buddy, Scott Rogowski, has a great show called Running Late with Scott Rogowski. May 1st, Mayday, Mayday, Mayday. 8 p.m. at the Slipper Room. That's 167 Orchard Street in New York City. Guess who Scott Rogowski is going to have on his show? Dick Cavett. Dick Cavett. Along with Impractical Jokers Sal Vulcano and The Best Show's Tom Sharpling. Tickets are $12 in advance, $15 at the door. Running Late with Scott Rogowski, May 1st, 8 p.m., The Slipper Room, 167 Orchard Street, New York City, Dick Cavett.
You're listening to the David Feldman radio program, You Sad Pathetic Hump.
I'll say, David, I'm in New York. Why
all
are
right,
we
all right,
doing
all
this?
All right, we're rolling, by the way. I just want to check my levels. It's very sad that I have to do all this, but my producer, Alex Brazell, he's in Spain right now.
Okay.
Yes, I'm doing everything by myself. And by the way, he lives at 501 Clingston Street in Edgewater, New Jersey. He leaves the back door open, and if... he's got a Ty Cobb rookie card framed above his bed. If anybody wants to take a look at it, it's...
I love that you just put his personal address on.
I know that he would want people to come to his place, 501 Clingston Avenue, back door wide open. He's away for 2 weeks, and there's a Ty Cobb rookie card above his bed, and everybody should see it. Hey, are you still there?
Yep, I'm here, man.
This is exciting. This is so exciting. The White House Correspondents Dinner is tomorrow, Saturday. Hasan Minhaj from The Daily Show. What are you doing?
Nothing.
What are you doing?
Oh, I closed a window. Sorry about that.
Oh, you closed a window.
Yeah.
That's a good thing because...
Be distracting, yeah.
Well, you know what? A lot of people defenestrate in the middle of an interview with David Feldman.
Don't take it so personally, David. I was trying to make it better.
Oh, okay. But if you do defenestrate, hold on to the phone so we can hear. We had Brody Stevens. Brody Stevens peed on the show last
perfect,
week.
Perfect. There you go.
So if you
so could, at least I was not. I was only defenestrating. I mean,
yes,
not even. Yeah,
I'm
not even in the same league.
Many people accuse me of chronic defenestration, and this is why nobody listens to my show.
Can I do the introduction, please, without you jumping out the
please,
window?
Please, okay.
Thank
please,
you.
By all means.
Thank you. What was that?
Apologies.
What was that?
My apologies.
What was that sound?
That was me apologizing.
Yeah, but there was like the, okay. The what? You opened the window again, didn't you?
There are two windows open. I closed one.
This is turning out to be the greatest interview I've ever done.
We're off to the. There you go. All right. Okay. Both windows are now closed.
Okay, we're now.
We will not hear the ambient parking. Sorry, the honking of New York City anymore.
All right. 15 minutes into the interview, it's now time for my audience to know who I'm talking to. The White House.
Wait, what about the defenestration? You forgot about addressing that.
You know what? I'm going to jump out the window if you don't be quiet. The White House Correspondents Dinner is tomorrow, Saturday. Hasan Minhaj from The Daily Show will be performing. Unfortunately, I couldn't get Hasan Minhaj. I tried, but there's bad blood between me and The Daily. I don't know. Something, I don't know. He doesn't return my calls. Instead, we have one of the guys writing for Hasan Minhaj.
This is about as bad as it gets. I also do security for him, and I'm his driver. And I'm his driver.
We have his writer, Azhar Usman. He's a comedian, actor, and writer. He's one of the stars of the new Amazon series, Patriot, which has been renewed for a second season. He's toured over 25 countries as a comedian. Dave Chappelle calls him untouchable, which is why Azhar has opened for Dave.
Azhar, you keep fucking it up, man. It's Azhar. But that's all right. David, go ahead, please.
Azhar.
Continue. Yes. I just want to make it the worst introduction at this point in the history of the David Feldman podcast.
Dave please, Chappelle continue. Dave Chappelle calls Azhar Usher. He calls you Usher behind your back.
And that's where you got it from? I got
yeah.
you.
And he calls Azhar untouchable.
Untouchable. Untouchable.
Untouchable.
Spanish. I don't know if this is a fake laugh. Are you real laughing?
Yeah, but that's all the time. We're all out of time. We're all out of time.
It's
thank you.
It's been wonderful to be with you.
Thanks for doing this.
I really appreciate it.
So thank you for doing this. So let's start off with the White House Correspondents Dinner. How do you sleep at night? Supporting.
Man, it's been very difficult, to be honest with you.
But it's wrong. It's immoral. The White House Correspondents Dinner is immoral, and you shouldn't be going there, even if Trump isn't showing up.
Well, how do you figure that it's immoral?
Because it's self-aggrandizement. It's the press wasting millions of dollars celebrating themselves when they should be out covering Trump, covering the crimes that are being committed in our name. Instead, they've turned this into their own Academy Awards. Aren't we great? And then they go, oh, but we, you know, we have a couple of scholarships for young reporters. It's BS. It's got to come to an end. And you have to draw a line in the sand, my friend, and boycott tomorrow's White House Correspondents. You and Hasan, get me Hasan on the line. He needs to cancel at the last minute and send a
signal. Oh, my God, how amazing would that be?
He needs to send a signal that this has to stop. It has to stop.
I don't know how much of this is you being 100% serious. I know that there's some, clearly, there's some sincere content behind what you're saying. But I feel like it's 90-10, like 90% bullshit, 10% serious. But, I mean, look, to answer your question, how do I sleep at night? I mean, it's not because of the moral dilemma. It's because of the pressure to navigate a freaking minefield of all these competing considerations with all the, you know, there's a lot of tension, man. Trump's not coming. He's basically prohibited anybody from his administration from attending. And so trying to make, you know, the people in the room laugh, but also keeping an eye towards the fact that anybody who watches it really will watch it online later. And how do you write a killer set for that context has been, it's been an interesting challenge, man.
Yeah.
I guess
you've written for these like award shows and stuff for other people.
I don't think I ever wrote for a White House Correspondents Dinner. It's a tough one because normally you have to go on after the president.
Right.
Which is just
a little less pressure for that reason. That's one good thing.
Right. You don't have to follow the president. Although, did you see the Al Smith dinner last year?
I feel like I did not see it last year.
Well, the Al Smith dinner for our listeners around the world, and we do have listeners around the world.
Nice.
The Al Smith
dinner. All six of them? Was six of them?
All six.
Got it.
Seven if you include the former KGB. They listen to everything I do.
They're listening to everything.
Yeah, they listen to everything. So the Al Smith dinner is held every year at the Waldorf. It's for the Catholic Church. Al Smith was a...
Yeah, I did see that. Yes, I did see that. With when Trump and Hillary both went up.
Yes.
Go ahead, sorry.
It was remarkable because Hillary was, you know, in the ballpark funny. She took some jokes from her writers and she told them, and she's not a intrinsically funny person the way Obama was or McCain was funny, but she did okay. And then Donald, he's an expert on everything, he knows everything, so he just got up there. He didn't need writers, and it was amazing to watch. So tone deaf. So wrong, so bad. Which is surprising because he's got the moves of a comedian when he does one of his rallies, right? He's kind of...
Yeah, oh no, absolutely. I remember watching his set on that and thinking like, man, he just had bad, you know, advice from comics or writers, because whoever wrote those quote-unquote jokes for him just didn't play to his strengths, and the fact that the guy is already inherently hilarious and is constantly, you know, just being himself, he's funny. Mm-hmm. He didn't need to dig so hard. He really started attacking Hillary, and just the crowd turned on him really bad.
Right.
Anyway, it was a thing of beauty.
Yeah.
Watching this guy bomb in front of
the entire audience. Let's address the elephant in the room. You are
the camel in the room.
Well, I was going to make the fact that you're Indian.
I am Indian,
and you're on top of an elephant. That was the joke I was going to go for. But I like the camel in the room better. Let's address the camel in the room.
Shall we?
Yeah. Let me
go ahead.
So, you are Muslim.
I am.
But you're from Indian parents.
Correct.
And I'm sorry. That would be Native Indian parents, right?
Well, if we say Native Indian, it makes people think Native American.
What happened? What did you break?
My boy Mo Ammer is in the room, and he's just like a bull in a china shop, dropping things and destroying the property.
Mm-hmm.
So he accidentally dropped something. I think he dropped some cologne on the desk. Okay. But he's leaving the room to make some
noise peace elsewhere. And quiet. He's going to make noise elsewhere. So if you live in India, and you're Indian,
you
would be a Native Indian.
That is correct.
Okay,
that is correct.
And yet you're Muslim, so why didn't you move to Pakistan? Why didn't your grandparents move to Pakistan when Lord Mountbatten separated?
Very good question. Fair question, man. So, well, first of all, just thank you for being aware of that history. And it's so funny to me because, you know, I grew up Muslim in the United States, complaining to my parents, like, you have no idea what it feels like to be a minority. And they're like, dude, we grew up Muslim in India. What the hell are you talking about? Yes, we do know what it feels like to be a minority. And it was not until I, you know, became an adult and ran the numbers and figured out, like, though Muslims in India are statistically a minority, it's such a big country that nominally the actual number of Muslims in India is huge. It's like 100 and something million. And there are actually more Indian Muslims on earth than there are Arab Muslims combined.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's pretty insane.
Okay, let me ask you a question about this.
Mm-hmm.
Is it fair to say that the Muslims in India are doing better because they're a minority
than they are in Pakistan, where they're the majority. Is there some empowerment that comes with being a minority?
I would say yes and no. I mean, the thing is, Muslims in India are, you know, kind of ghettoized in a lot of ways. And there's a lot of poverty. You know, Hyderabad is probably one of the largest states where there's a significant Muslim population. And it's, you know, kind of very similar and analogous to the way in our country we have a very clear racial divide and access to resources. You know, the structural aspects of racism that limit access to education, housing, and economic opportunity, those same phenomena are alive and well across the planet. And so you can pick any minority group pretty much anywhere and you'll find a very similar type of dynamic. So India is no exception to that.
But you do have very successful Muslims living in India.
Yeah, and that's what I was about to say. Now, having said that, that might be the rule, but there are definitely, you know, a number of exceptional cases where you might have, you know, people rising to tremendous levels of prominence, either in business or academia or media or what have you.
Dave Chappelle called you untouchable. Untouchable in India would make you... I'm being serious.
Of course, I know. The caste system, yeah.
Well, if you're not going to treat me with respect... You have a legal degree, don't you?
I do. I used to be a lawyer, man. Wait, were you an attorney as well?
No, I'm going through a divorce, and
I'm sorry, just so you know,
as we go further into this interview, I am going to be disrespectful to you.
That's not, perfectly fine.
Not because I'm Jewish, and you're Muslim. It's because you're an attorney.
So, well, all I can say to that is Shabbat Shalom. Do your thing.
Boy, you really are a sleazy attorney.
used to be. I'm a recovering attorney.
So just so the people listening, this is not resentment that you grew up in Skokie as a Muslim and your parents secretly encouraged the Nazis to march in Skokie. I know the truth.
Don't even joke about that.
I know.
Come on, man.
Were you alive? Were you born yet when they marched in Skokie?
No, I was not alive when they marched, but I was born in 1975.
Okay.
But I do distinctly remember when I learned about the whole history, because the Skokie Public Library, when I was in, I think, middle school or high school, had unveiled this Holocaust memorial outside the library, which was, of course, you know, expeditiously graffitied by some neo-Nazis with a swastika. And then it became a whole, obviously, you know, new situation, and everybody was talking about it. And then in the midst of that whole controversy at that time, I, for the first time ever, just learned about all this incredible history. Skokie is the subject of, a landmark Supreme Court case, a documentary film made about it, a feature film made about it. So I was like, oh my God, this is a very historic town. And it's interesting to me now as a comic, because it's like that whole dispute was over free speech.
Right.
And it's interesting also that the ACLU at that time, this is how the country is completely flipped, represented the neo-Nazis.
Mm-hmm. Well, they still would.
They still would, exactly. But what I'm saying now, they are now.
They would represent Ann Coulter, who's an original Nazi. She's an OG.
How weird would that be? The ACLU representing Steve Bannon as a Nazi?
They would.
It's isn't that the heart of the whole argument that's happening?
Yeah, I have three.
Is hate speech free speech? That's the question.
Your Honor, I would like to control the line of questioning here.
Please.
Okay, so there are three areas that I want to talk about with you right now. I want to talk about Ann Coulter, freedom of speech. Mm-hmm. So write that down. We'll get to Ann Coulter in a second. Okay. I also want to talk about you saying, let's not joke about that. I kind of offended you when I said your parents invited the
supported the neo-Nazis.
Yeah, I want to talk to you about that in a second, because that's about political correctness and who can make jokes and who can't.
Yes.
But we glossed over something that's really important, and that was Lord Mountbatten, after World War II, he was kind of the emperor. Well, not the emperor, but he was in charge of India. And he had to solve a problem. And the problem was, what do you do with the people of India, the Hindu and the Sikhs and the Muslims? And he, I believe, after World War II, came up with the idea of a partition. He said, we'll put... Are you still there?
I'm here. I'm listening. Yeah.
He said, we'll put the Hindus and the Sikh over here, and we'll create Pakistan and put all the Muslims over there. Is that how it worked?
Well, okay, I'm not going to pretend to be an expert on the political intrigue that took place at that time as to what led to the partition. Because,
well, then tell me about did Lord Mountbatten's wife bang Nehru?
That I can confirm with 100% certainty happened.
She was banging.
No, I'm just kidding. I have no idea, man.
Lord Mountbatten's wife was in India, and she was banging Nehru.
Nehru. Is that really confirmed?
That's an absolute truth. And Mountbatten was the one who introduced Queen Elizabeth to Prince Philip. And the last name of the royal family should be Mountbatten. But they went with Windsor, which was like a slap in the face to Lord Mountbatten, who had a big influence on Prince Charles. And Lord Mountbatten was killed by the IRA. And the police are coming to get us because I know the truth.
Yeah, I can hear that. This is crazy.
Okay.
Wow. I need to look into this a lot more. Let me just say that India-Pakistan partition obviously is and probably will remain, you know, a hot button, very sensitive kind of political sensitivity on both sides. And then, of course, the religious component to it, you know, makes people even more hypersensitive. But I'll just tell you that I've heard too many different theories and, you know, stories behind the stories of what really happened and why did the partition happen and who wanted it to happen and what were the commercial interests behind it, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm just going to go on this one and say I don't really know what happened. Mm-hmm. I just feel like I feel about partition kind of the way I feel about 9/11. Like, I don't know what really happened, but I know I don't believe the official story.
But it was an outside job.
I don't know what really happened.
No, the partition was an outside job.
Well, I mean, that's the thing. There's theories about, you know, political intrigue between Jawaharlal Nehru and what's his name? You know,
Mountbatten.
The founder of Pakistan. Oh my God, this is so embarrassing. Neither of us is. They call him
Stan.
Stan. That's right, Stan. What is it? Weisenthal? No.
Stanley Weisenthal.
Stanley Weisenthal. I think
of course. You think they're going to trust a Muslim to start at their own country? You actually think the Pope is Catholic? They had to bring a Jew in. Do you think... You don't know about Bin Laden being Jewish?
It was Bin Laden. Benjamin Laden.
Come on, you think the Saudi Arabians, those princes, are going to trust one of their own to pull off something as complicated as 9/11? Originally it was 9/12. Originally it was 9/12. They said, for you, 9/11.
It would have been 9/10, but they're always a day late.
All right, you said don't even joke about that.
Well, you know what it is? It's not that I could care less. I could take the joke. I'm afraid. See, the problem is if people don't get the joke, mm-hmm. then the joke is out of the context. And, you know, context is everything. And so, sadly, you know, I'm going to tell you about my own self now. You know, my own awareness and hyper-awareness around... You know, growing up in Skokie, man, my whole life I've been around Jewish people and have developed almost kind of like a I'm an honorary member of the tribe, you know, like Nazi jokes, Hitler jokes, you know, people in our culture, I feel like in America, oftentimes without really the proper context will engage in some of these jokes.
Right.
And even if the joke on it, you know, just in itself is a funny joke, it's a, might be a well-constructed joke, but it's just highly insensitive, or it's done in a way that doesn't acknowledge, you know, the energy and the feeling and the emotion behind it. And I've come to the conclusion, David, that, you know, context is everything, and also intention is everything.
Right.
Intent of the speaker.
And what is that called? Is that mens rea? What is the?
Well, mens rea, right? In the law, it's sort of the criminal mind, the criminal intent. That's more in the criminal context.
Right.
But just the subjective intent of the speaker, what's in their heart when they're saying the X, Y, or Z, never gets talked about, man. In the debacles that happen when comics do edgy jokes and then end up offending somebody, and then it turns into a situation, and then they're pressed to apologize, we never end up discussing or exploring the subjective intent.
And that to me, but that to me is why censorship is so important, and why I'm for censorship. And I'm, I just proved a point I'm about to make, and I'm being serious.
Okay.
We need censorship because I can say whatever I want on this show, and as long as people are laughing, it's okay. And what's happened is people like Ann Coulter and Rush Limbaugh will always say, when they're caught saying something horrible, I was joking. I was joking. Mm. And once they say, I was joking, then the intent is not to hurt, but to entertain. So I do believe that, and I'm being serious, censorship in a civilized society, there's a reason we don't talk a certain way, because we might offend somebody inadvertently. That's why language, and I sound so condescending right now to my audience, but language is important. Words we choose are important. That's why we have grammar police. That's why we have dictionaries. That's why we have laws. And in a civilized society, and it used to be this way, we don't make racial jokes. We don't make ethnic jokes. We don't do that in a civilized, polite society because it might offend somebody. But as the country gets dumber and dumber, the only wit at our disposal is ethnic humor, racial humor, and then we wrap it around the First Amendment as though it's something important instead of just plain stupid.
Well, I mean, it's an interesting take. I don't agree that the conclusion of it is we need censorship. I think that you might, your diagnosis might be on, but maybe your prescription is off.
Well, you know,
because can I tell you why?
Sure.
Because you know, everything you just said about, you know, we don't do that in a civilized society. Well, first of all, people do that. They just do it behind closed doors.
That's okay.
Okay.
That's okay.
So you're saying censorship in the public sphere. We need to limit public speech.
I'm saying, first of all, I don't know if I believe this, and that's the danger of people like Ann Coulter and Rush Limbaugh saying things, spitballing, running up the flagpole to see if anybody salutes. The problem is, I'm just thinking out loud, and I shouldn't be thinking. And I shouldn't be thinking out loud in front.
You should not, because look, the question of censorship, right? This is at the heart, I would say, of really what the whole world is fighting about. You know, what does it mean to be a free society? And if you sacrifice one of the most cherished cornerstones of a free, liberal, open society, which is free speech, by trying to limit what people can say, you have literally sort of cut the legs out from underneath the very basis of why we are a free speech culture, why we are a First Amendment culture. Now, let me say this, though. I agree that hate speech is a problem. But what we have not resolved as a society, as a culture, and as a civilization is hate speech still free, protected speech or not? If it's not, we have to figure out what constitutes hate speech. And that's where the rubber meets the road, because it's highly contested, ambiguous, and virtually, therefore, impossible to resolve.
But a civilized... So, hang on for one second. Again, I emotionally, I believe this, not intellectually, but almost intellectually, I believe this. A civilized society knows what hate speech is. Remember the definition of pornography?
Right. I know it when I see it.
I know it when I see it. What has happened is the right wing, the conservatives, have been hijacked by racists, by people who believe that the Confederacy should have won the Civil War.
The so-called alt-right.
Yes. It's been hijacked. And they've turned everything into subjectivity, and everything revolves around the First Amendment. A civilized society has arrived at truths like slavery is wrong. You don't persecute Arabs and Mexicans. A civilized society knows what's wrong and what's right. And so
you can oppress Arabs in Israel. That's okay.
Well, you're a lawyer. You know that
it gets complicated.
No, you fight like a woman. You know that you're not a lawyer.
Let's start talking about it, bro. This is a conversation that America needs to have. There are two conversations that the alt-right has forced on America.
But you brought up Israel. I want to go back to Ann Coulter and the First Amendment. Let's stay in America, because
Mexicans and Arabs, you can't oppress Arabs and Mexicans. You can't.
No, I'm talking about Ann Coulter's right to speak at Berkeley. First of all, she's being paid $20,000 by the YAF and Bridge USA. So it's not free speech. She's doing it for $20,000. She's doing it to provoke Berkeley. Why, you know, of all the places to speak in the Bay Area, why Berkeley? She's doing it as a cause celeb, and it costs $20,000 for her to come on campus, and then the protests, and then the protection. For what purpose? To increase the value of her quote-unquote brand.
Sure.
I don't want any part of it. We all know what this is about. It's not a slippery slope. She is a vile, disgusting pig. She's a racist. She justifies oppression of women, of Mexicans and Arabs. In any civilized society, she would be recognized as a purveyor of hate speech. What's the debate?
Well, hold on, but I would argue that, first of all, everything you just said is true. You're on a podcast right now with me saying that she is a vile, you know, a racist, etc. So she is being reviled. The only thing we're arguing is, should it be illegal? Should it be outlawed that she is not allowed to publicly say, you know,
I'm the chancellor of Berkeley. Yes, I know we get public. It's a public school. I get it. So the First Amendment is at play here because public funding. But as a radio show, as a podcast, I'm free to say you're not allowed on my show. And that's not a violation of her First Amendment. They're being slippery using the First Amendment because UC Berkeley is using government funds. So it's a First Amendment issue. But otherwise, it's not a First Amendment issue.
I mean, look, here's what it comes down to, I think. This is a never-ending oceanic discussion, right? People have been debating this for hundreds of years, and they will continue to debate it probably for a very long time. But I think that the distinction we need to make is, what is the behavior we are interested in trying to regulate as a matter of law versus the behavior we are interested in regulating as a matter of just social courtesy, mores, norms, etc. Everything you said about how a civilized society ought to be, you know, we shouldn't, it should not be racist, it should not be, you know, sexist, it should not be xenophobic, it should not be anti-Semitic, it should not be anti-immigrant, it should not be Islamophobic, it should not be all of the things that we as civilized people have come to figure out. These are all isms that are destructive to the type of society that we all want, that civilized people want. I'm arguing that all of those things, as bad as they might be, ought to be regulated as a matter of social, you know, custom and mores, but they should not be turned into matters that we want to regulate as a matter of law when it comes to speech. You know, you can say racist things, but you cannot, but the law will regulate your action and not enable you to implement, you know, racist policy, for example, as an employer or what have you. So we have tried, the country, we've been trying to figure out how, where to draw that line. And I would argue that the line is kind of moving. That's the part of the problem is, you know, is, I come back to it, is hate speech free speech? Yes or no? And if it's not, then we have to define it. What constitutes hate speech? And that's, you know, good luck figuring that out. That's,
well,
almost impossible.
You know, we have to wrap it up, and you'll come back, and I'll give you the last word. And we didn't even touch the surface of, because your introduction was so long. Money, Citizens United. Yes, Citizens United, they tell us that money is speech. If money is speech, everything is speech. And heckling is speech. And saying to Ann Coulter, you can't come on my campus, is speech. Everything is protected. The First Amendment protects everything. If money is speech, then I'm free to spend my money any way I want. And Ann Coulter is getting $20,000 to speak at Berkeley. She's not being paid by Berkeley. She's being paid by right-wing provocateurs who could have chosen any place on earth to pay her $20,000 to speak. And they chose Berkeley because Milo Yiannopoulos tried to speak there in February or January, and a riot broke out. And that's what the right wing wants to do. They want to create a riot on campus in Berkeley. And I'm looking at what's going on with the Trump administration and the EPA being denuded of its regulatory rights. And I'm thinking, do I really need to be discussing this cow, this bulimic, hateful, barren, half-human, half-harpy, wanting to speak on the campus at Berkeley? I thought we destroyed her on the Comedy Central roast. Why is she rearing her ugly butt? And why are we discussing her? I'm so tired.
Tell me how you really feel.
I'm so tired of this First Amendment argument. You know what it is? It's an argument for people who are lazy. It's a lazy argument. There's a tax plan that has to be addressed. There is a Russian oligarch who is taking over our election. And we're still discussing whether or not Ann Coulter has the right to speak at Berkeley. Who cares?
Yeah, but okay, I can agree with everything you just said. But to me, it's like the solution to this problem is not that we should therefore censor her. It's just we shouldn't talk about it. Let them try to be provocateurs. Who is deciding that this is a news story that is going to end up on the front page of Yahoo News?
Lazy people like me who have Trump fatigue, and they have to do, and I have to do a show. I have to do this show, and when I read about the tax plan, I get so depressed. The only thing that energizes me is Ann Coulter. It's lazy. Gotcha. It's lazy.
Okay, well then, so then that laziness is what we should be banning, not the right to speak. I mean, I'm a huge free speech advocate. So my argument has always been, I became sold on this in law school, in fact, which is that the solution to bad speech, even hateful speech, is not less speech. It's more speech. You don't like Ann Coulter, you know, if the right wing and the alt-right are putting all these provocateurs in place and implementing this effective strategy to get more awareness around what they're doing and create, you know, situations by provoking either a riot or a negative response by a university, which then leads to a news story. Where is the counter voice? Where are the people organizing speakers on campuses to refute them, to debate these people, to, you know, shame them for the racist that they are? Where is that narrative? It's like, it's so much easier to call for the banning of a book or the burning of a book than it is to write the counter narrative.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like, yeah, it is laziness. And I'm sort of sick of social justice warriors that want to complain about how bad the alt-right is and how they're... It's like, you know what? They're producing these quack public intellectuals. Where's the countervailing voices? You don't like what they're saying? Refute them in the public open marketplace of ideas. I wish there was more energy put into crafting and articulating convincing counterarguments and counter figures than there is put into just, you know, rah, 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 screaming and shouting and yelling and trying to shout down people.
I mean, in this country, how often are you asked to appear on mainstream media to give a rational, legal opinion?
Not very often.
And yet you're a lawyer and a comedian.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, that there you go. I mean, it's... you also know this. You're a smart guy. All the mass media, pretty much, you know, in the United States and really now around the world, is just consistently getting consolidated slowly but surely into the hands of a handful of conglomerates that own all the film studios, all the TV channels, all the radio stations, all the newspapers, all the magazines, all the book publishers, all the billboard companies. It's in the hands of a few people, man. So the narrative becomes so, you know, narrow. And I'm sure you know the stats. I mean, Trump was given over $5 billion of free advertising, free media. Well, whose decision was that? It's not the public that's deciding that. You know, it's because executives at media corporate media entities know that Trump, as much as hateful as the shit that he says is, he's good for business. You know, when Trump brags about my ratings are great, you know, he's not talking about Celebrity Apprentice. He means when I'm on your channel, you're going to make money. He recently said the ratings had never been as high, since the towers fell. He said that a couple days ago. He's comparing himself to 9/11. That's a real thing. It's insane. But that's what it is, man. These guys are making money, man. CNN, you know, Fox News, etc. You know, they all make money off Trump. They air commercials. This weekend he's going to be doing that Pennsylvania rally while the White House Correspondents Dinner is happening. They're all going to be there. Their cameras are going to be rolling. Uh-huh. They're going to be cutting to commercials, and they're going to be making money. So that's also real. Nobody wants to talk about that. The so-called left-wing, you know, liberal media, the content of what you're saying might be critiquing Trump, but you're still talking about fucking Trump. Mm-hmm. And Kellyanne Conway and Spicer and. Like, it's just a circus, man.
Right.
We're living in a reality show, my friend.
Well, there have to be twists and turns, and it's a reality show. It's also this ongoing Perry Mason. There's a Law and Order factor in that we keep thinking now he's caught. Oh, no, he's not. Now he's caught.
I mean, it's so absurd because it's like, what else? What, he's already done enough evil shit that should have tanked him. The guy is Teflon, man. He said it himself. I could shoot a guy in the middle of Manhattan and my ratings would go up.
It's not
approval rating go up.
It's not Teflon. It's like a document dump. When, you know, when the White House doesn't want you to find something at the, or in a lawsuit, you just pile the opposing counsel
with discovery,
thousands and thousands of documents. They get bogged down going through it, and they can't even see the crime. There is a document dump going on with Trump in that everybody he surrounds himself with is a criminal. So at what point, you don't even know where to begin to prosecute. And that is really how an autocracy, a kleptocracy works. That's how a Latin American banana republic works, is that everybody is corrupt, which means that nobody's corrupt.
Yeah, man, it's so depressing. I agree with you 100%. I mean, the other benefit of, you know, if you know more about just the rest of the world, I think that there's a, you know, the myth of American exceptionalism that most Americans either consciously or unconsciously just drink up because, you know, since you're a kid in this country, you're brainwashed into this idea that America's the greatest country in the world, America's the greatest country in the world. And if you really believe it, you start to think that, no, we're different. The rest of the world operates, you know, in this very corrupt way, but we're different. And Trump is just sort of like the guy who just pulled back the curtain. And he was like, no, we're not that different.
We're not that different.
Yeah, people, we do the same thing as everyone else.
We do, you know, and we accept one indignity after another. This is a country that is ruled, like you said, by a handful of people. And their objective is to suck up as much money as possible. We all think, we're convinced, we're a nation of laws until we go through the criminal justice system or the court system or the family law system, and you discover, no, we're a nation of lawyers, not laws, lawyers.
Right. Yeah, it's true.
But
here's the thing. Here's what I've concluded about this. You know, we all kind of have this ideal in our minds, how we imagine things ought to be, this society of law and order and perfect justice and, you know, a total meritocracy, and everybody is judged based on the content of their character, and, you know, you get ahead in life because you work hard and you have integrity, and that's how the society should work. And we imagine that, wouldn't it be great if that we could live in a world like that? And that's great. That's a wonderful dream. But nobody gets that. That's never existed in human history. And so the idea is to maintain that ideal and just keep chipping towards, you know, towards it and trying to get better. So I'm saying to you that America is actually, you know, far less corrupt, in my belief, than certain other societies on the earth. And at the same time, it is not, I don't believe in blanket, you know, unqualified American exceptionalism as though America is just, you know, above any wrongdoing. You know, our foreign policy, I mean, so many aspects of the way our country is working, and especially now, it's gotten just more grotesque. You know, there's always been conflicts of interest being a president, but it's never been like this. This guy is a multi-billionaire, global businessman who, out of one side of their mouth, they hate on globalists. You know, it's so funny to me. I wrote a joke about this. Like, I will literally go to my grave never understanding Trump supporters who would go around saying, you know, we got to do something about these goddamn billionaires, you know, taking over our country. We got to take our country back from these goddamn globalist multinational billionaires. And that's why I'm going to vote for a global multinational billionaire. What the fuck are you talking about, dude? Like, this guy is exactly the guy you hate. Like, it makes absolutely zero rational, logical sense. Their complaints are valid. Let me ask you this.
God has a sense of humor. History is funny.
Yes.
What if Donald Trump turns out to be the most transparent president we've ever had? In that, hang on for one second. We know everything about him.
Yes.
Yeah, he's an open book. Except for his taxes, he's pretty much an open book, right? Except for his taxes.
Yeah, fair point.
And I have a feeling the reason he's not releasing his taxes is it'll be boring.
just like he wants to wave that in front of everybody as a distraction, and there's probably nothing in there. I don't really believe that.
I have a theory.
Okay, I'm just hypothesizing, but let me just say one thing, and then you can tell your theory. My beloved Barack Obama is getting $400,000 to speak at Cantor Fitzgerald. Now, Cantor Fitzgerald was one of the stock trading firms that was decimated after 9/11. They have $400,000 to give to Barack Obama. I would rather that money goes to the first responders, the families of the first responders who are still suffering from breathing in that air. But Cantor Fitzgerald, which was almost wiped out after 9/11, is going to give Barack Obama $400,000 to speak. I love Barack Obama. He's on my team. But that doesn't smell right. That doesn't smell right for a liberal Democratic president who defeated Hillary Clinton because she was the one who took the money from Goldman Sachs. He should not be taking $400,000 from Cantor Fitzgerald, especially since Cantor Fitzgerald is linked to 9/11. And they should be giving that money to first responders. The point I'm making is Donald Trump could be the most transparent president we've ever had because he's just flaunting his corruption and his hypocrisy.
It's a fair point. It's a fair point. I mean, he may very well be. I mean, did you see the interview he did with Bill O'Reilly right before the Super Bowl? Where O'Reilly asked him, do you respect Putin? And Trump says, yeah, I do. You know, he's a leader of a country. He leads this country. I respect him. And O'Reilly says, yeah, but he's a killer. You know, he's killed people. And Trump, I swear to God, Trump says this. He goes, you think we're so innocent?
Right. Right.
We got a lot of killers here. Iraq war, this, that. I mean, it is stunning to watch a sitting president basically indicting the United States as being, you know, as corrupt as any other dictatorship or, you know, any other thug power on the world scene. That's shocking.
Yeah.
And it's also on the other hand, it's sort of like, well, he has a point.
He has a point. In Trump's America, even a broken clock is right 24 hours a day. Is that funny?
That's a good flip. I like it.
I just made that clever up.
I like taking like hacky sounding old jokes.
Uh-huh.
If you could flip it.
Hold on,
but I want to give you a theory about the tax return thing.
Okay.
Did you know that when Trump was roasted on Comedy Central,
I was there. I wrote it.
Okay. Oh, you wrote it. So then you know that the one rule. What was the one rule that you guys were given? You can't joke about how much he says he's worth.
Yeah. I'll tell you something else. You want to know something else?
Of course I do, please.
He was supposed to give all that money to charity. And we never found out what the charity was. He never proved, this is what I've heard. He allegedly never informed us where that money went.
Interesting.
So he said the money was going to charity.
Did you guys pay him in rubles?
Well, we have to. Hey, listen. You're my new best friend. You're my new best friend.
I'm a big fan of yours.
I have a prepared outro.
Let's do it. Hold on, but we can't. You can't finish right now because I hinted at a can of worms and we never finished it. I don't want to piss off any of your listeners.
What was the can of worms?
Well, you know, I said there's two conversations America that Trump winning has forced on America. White America needs to have a conversation about the history and legacy of slavery in this country so that white liberals can get over the white guilt and we can have a constructive conversation. And because we know how the right wing feels about slavery. They're like, yeah, let's bring it back. But I feel like the left in this country is so unable to process their white guilt, and it's really a hindrance towards making true progress. And the second conversation, which is what I hinted at when I said Israel, when I brought up Israel, mm-hmm. is the fact, and I'm saying this as somebody who grew up with Jewish people. So this is not coming.
You're saying some, need, are you saying some of your best friends are Jews? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. I'm using a stock line from racists because America needs to start having a conversation with herself, and Jews in America need to help this conversation happen, which is that critique of Israeli right-wing violent Zionist policies that are represented by only a fringe radical within Israeli politics. Critiquing that is not anti-Semitism. Please, let's stop this nonsense.
Okay. We have to wrap it up because this is, I have a Muslim on my show who is making sense, and he's cogent and convincing and knows what he's talking about, so we have to cut you off.
Fair enough. I understand. I understand how it works.
Yeah, and now you and you're also bridging the gap between Jews and Muslims in America. That doesn't further the cause of perpetual debate in order to do
from one mensch to another, my friend.
You know, on my show, it's a constant debate. And if you're talking about what we have in common and our similarities and how we can all work together towards justice and peace, that's not entertaining. This show has to be about fighting and debating and arguing and name calling. So we have
to. Well, I'm also a member of ISIS. We didn't finish that. Get to Clark and Kerry.
But here I have my standard closing is this, because this makes me sound good, okay? Because I'm Jewish and you're a Muslim.
Yes, sir.
Ready? No, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to call you my brother. I'm not going to say brother. I'm not going to call you my brother. I'm going to call you my sister.
Fair enough. It's just a construct.
All right, let me just wrap this up. This is the part. I got this down by the numbers. I've been doing this for so long. Now I start calling you my brother, because then it endears me to you and the audience, and I sound very, you know, like I'm all about peace, brother. Okay, brother?
Sounds good, brother.
Okay, brother. So, brother, tomorrow night we should all watch the White House Correspondents Dinner. My brother Hassan Minhaj will be telling jokes to my brothers at the White House Correspondents Dinner. Right, brother?
I think that's right. I think there might be some sisters there and maybe some people who are them.
Right, brother. And, brother, where can people see you do comedy, brother?
Brother, I am doing stand-up sets at the Cellar in Manhattan this week, and I am based out of Chicago. I have a monthly show called In Polite Company, a political comedy show about race, religion, and politics at the Chicago Laugh Factory every month. People can check all that out on my website, which is azhar.com, A-Z-H-A-R.com.
Brother, can you spell your full name, brother?
I will, brother. It's spelled D-A-V-I-D-F-E-L-D-M-A-N.
That's my name, brother.
Oh, my God. We're so close. I sometimes forget who's who. My name is spelled Azhar. A-Z as in zebra, H-A-R.com.
And, brother, how do people follow you on Facebook and Twitter?
The links are actually on that website. Twitter handle is just my full name, Azhar Usman, A-Z-H-A-R-U-S-M-A-N. It's like U.S. man. Mm-hmm. And they can just search my name on Facebook and find the fan page as well.
Hey, brother, man, let's do the bit that we talked about doing at the top of the show, brother.
Sounds good, brother.
No, do the bit.
What bit? What was the bit?
But while you're on Skype.
Why I'm on Skype?
Why are we doing this interview on Skype?
Oh, yeah, right. You know, I reached out to you, let you know I was back in Manhattan. We had been trying to get this thing scheduled.
That's right, brother.
So given that I'm in New York, I said, hey, man, let's do it. And you said, I can't be in the same room as you, so let's do it over Skype. That's pretty much the way it went down, right?
Right, brother. I mean, you understand, brother, that...
Brother, I get it. Who are you talking to?
You're in the room next door.
You know, defenestration is required.
But you understand, brother. You understand that even though we're different, you understand where I'm coming from, where I cannot be in the same room with you.
I get it. I do understand. I mean,
even though you're next door, we have to do it via Skype, brother, because you respect my values, brother, right?
100%, yeah. And you got to be careful who you're seen with, you know what I mean? And like a picture with me, yeah. NSA, you know, they're watching, you know, it's...
so.
I'm just letting you know, by the way, coming on your show, you've been added to probably a few lists.
Okay, brother. But by the way, if we run into each other in the hall, brother, I don't make eye contact, brother, and I don't want to ride in the same elevator with you, brother. You understand where I'm coming from, brother, don't you?
Brother, I'm hoping that the brother bit is holding up, brother. I'm hoping your listeners are like, why is he continuing? Why?
Hey, how long are you in town, brother?
Well, brother, I don't even know at the moment. I'm either flying home tomorrow or I'm here for another few days.
Okay.
I might get a gig in Long Island or whatever.
Okay. I would have coffee with you, brother, but we'll have to do it via Skype.
We'll do it. I'll be back.
You understand, brother.
No, we should have dinner sometime, man. Let's just make sure we do it over Google Hangout.
I love you.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
Man. I'll take it. Hey, Feldman, thanks for having me on.
Thanks
man.
For doing it, man. Thank All you, right, sir.
Thanks, man.
Bye.
Thanks for listening. What a great show, huh? This was a great show. Thank you so much for listening. Please friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. You'll see an Amazon banner. Click on it and then shop away. And we get a small percentage of everything you purchase. For $5 a month, you can gain access to our premium content. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. You'll see Go Premium. Hit that, and then you can sign up. We accept all major credit cards. We just added Marty Short and Andy Kindler to our premium content. We're curating some of our stuff. If you already are a premium subscriber and you forgot the password, hit the contact button over at davidfeldmanshow.com, and we will send you the password. It hasn't changed, but we will send you the password anyway. Hit the contact button to tell me what you like about the show and what you dislike. I answer all my emails. I'm a little behind because Alex Brazell, my producer, went to Spain for 2 weeks. So this has been difficult. But I will get to all the emails. Hey, remember tomorrow night, Saturday, 7:30 p.m. QED in Astoria, Queens. We're doing a live taping of the David Feldman Show. Look at who we have on this show. Comedian Sean Donnelly, who you've seen on Conan and Letterman. He will be my guest, along with David Feldman Show regulars Angela Cobb and Pat Dixon. Pat Dixon from the New York City Crime Report. You know him. Many of you dislike him. I love him. He's funny. He kicked my ass on a roast battle. You don't want to miss this show. Tickets are only $8. To purchase in advance, go to QEDAstoria.com and search for the David Feldman Show. I will personally shake everybody's hand after the show, and you can run your fingers through my plugs. Go to QEDAstoria.com. Did I mention everything? What am I leaving out? That I love you? I love you guys. Thank you. Thank you all for listening to this show. I can't do it without my listeners. I mean that. You're getting me through what we're all going through, and I thank you for that. From the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, Medicare for all, and for all, a good night.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.